closed session
with nothing to report. One and two were ixnayed off the agenda, so it was just a public performance evaluation that we looked at, and here we are. Open session. Here we go with the agenda.
I move to approve. Second.
Okay, second. Approved and seconded. Any questions?
No changes.
No.
Any changes?
No.
Call for a vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
Sounds unanimous. Fiscal matters. Oh my God, Michael. How are you?
Good, how are you?
Excellent. We're ready to go over the financial statement.
So my pleasure to present the financial statements for the Marinwood Community Service District. My name is Michael O'Connor. I'm the auditor in charge of the engagement. And so there's two documents. There's a financial statement and then there's a management report. I'll go through the financial statement first. Feel free to interrupt me with questions at any time. On page one is all the financial statements. It's our independent auditor's report. And it's an unqualified opinion, and which means the district is compliant following all the accounting standards that are applicable to it, as well as the audit was conducted in compliance with the standards for conducting audits. It will be on a letterhead. We do work for the board of directors. If you ever have questions of me or the firm I work for, you can contact us at any time.
Okay.
Let me go to page 8. Okay, so page 8 is your statement of net position, and this is prepared as if you were a for-profit corporation.
Okay.
The statements in here are you have a full accrual basis like a for-profit company, and then you also have modified accrual basis, which is close to cash basis, which is required for governments. So it's shown both ways. So your government net position, if you look at the bottom, their net position is a negative $470,389.
Mm-hmm. And this is modified accrual?
This is full accrual.
Full accrual?
Yeah.
Okay.
So that according to the new GASB rule, I believe was 73, 75, less than long-term liability in addition to the pension liability for the first time, right? Or has it always?
This is the second year.
Okay.
So it just hit you last year.
Okay.
So, and that is what has put you into a deficit position.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
The liabilities for the net pension liability, as well as your post-employment benefit liabilities, there is no real amortization schedule for them. There is no big payments coming down like you would have typical loan. So these aren't really loans.
Okay.
But anyway, so these things are not coming due anytime soon, so it's not something to get really stressed out about. But, but it is important that they're there.
Other than the fact that the annually required contribution for pensions is skyrocketing, and that is a cash outlay. That is not a future liability.
That's true. So how this is being paid down is your premiums go up
mm-hmm.
in the future. In this. But hopefully not this liability down.
And then, Michael, I'm looking on page 8 where it says due in more than 1 year. I mean, that's OPEB, correct?
Yes.
Great.
And then the net benefit is separate out.
Thank you.
And I believe it was the OPEB that increased by 3 million in the last 3 years.
Is that the future liability?
Yes, I'm jumping to page 30 at this point, but just a shortcut.
Okay, understood.
Sorry,
that's
to continue.
It's okay, that's the note for OPEB. What's going to happen is that you're only showing a proportion of it on page 31 has the full liability. 2 years from now, you're going to have to report the full liability.
2 years from now.
Okay, so next page is page 9. This is your statement of activities, the result of your operations for the year, again on the full accrual basis. It starts out with your expenditures, because the district is a government agency and they're in the business of providing services, and these are the cost of those services. So that's $6 million approximately spent this year. Then you have your charges for services. Then it, those net against the expenses, they come down to where the taxpayers are subsidizing. And then you have a change in net position. The third from the bottom line is a negative $176,024. Mm-hmm. So then if we go to page 10. So this is the modified accrual basis that governments typically report on. They used to report on these. These full accrual have just been in the last 10 years that have come into play. So on the modified accrual basis, your general fund, if you look at the second line from the bottom, you have $1.3 million in a general fund balance. And then you have your Measure A fund, which is assigned for Measure A, and then you have a debt service fund, which is money set aside for your debt.
I have a question. What threw me, you used the term general fund. The report shows assigned for capital replacement.
Yes.
Generally speaking, I don't think we've ever reserved for capital asset replacement since this district has been initiated. so is that indeed the general fund we're talking about?
That is. So when you, in fund balances, there's different types, but assigned fund balance can be assigned by management.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's, there's committed, which requires board approval, mm-hmm. and then restricted is related to an outside third party's restricting the money.
Right.
Technically, Measure A would be restricted, although we have it assigned here. But so I think the previous general manager, we discussed that, but we do have this facility, and there was a question about, you know, as far as maintenance and upkeep and work on this facility, as well as other you know, structures in your parks.
I see.
So I guess let me rephrase this question. If we were to have if we were to open an account that's board restricted, irrevocable trust of sort, dedicated to, let's say, OPEB liability, would that be listed on a separate line, or would that be part of the assigned for capital replacement?
No, you could list it on a separate line. If it was a board, it could be, you would have committed for retirement benefits or whatever, post-employment health benefits. So you could call it whatever
you
want.
And even if it's not irrevocable trust, even if it's a board-restricted fund, it would still be a separate line that would list it as, let's say, board-restricted for capital improvement, correct?
Well, wouldn't be, if you were doing it for OPEB, it wouldn't be for capital improvement.
Two different things.
Right.
So that's my second question, I guess. If we were to open a...
irrevocable trust.
Not an irrevocable trust, just a board-restricted fund. But that would be for capital improvements. Would that be part of the assigned for capital replacement line?
It can, yes, and unless you wanted to call it something different.
Okay, so it's up to us.
It's up to you, exactly.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So that's okay. And then I'm going to go to page 12. Also, the general fund, there's, you also have your fire services, so reserve for capital replacement also could be for fire engines as well. You have plenty of things to spend money on for capital. So on page 12, okay, this is your statement.
Can I ask you a quick question? Before we finalize this, if they wanted to change with how that was worded, could they make that decision tonight?
Yes.
I mean, because they can kind of word it wherever they want, assigned for, insert thing here, right?
They can. So assigned is management, committed as board.
Right, right. But and to your point, I mean, this is just what's been inherited from past audits, but it could be, could it say assigned for general operating?
It could. You could also have...
Well, unassigned.
So you would have unassigned.
Okay.
If it was for general operating.
Could we change it now? Do you want to change it, Jeff?
I believe it is unassigned.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You want to just take that line out instead of saying assigned for capital replacement, just call it unassigned?
Yeah, because I mean, it does...
Yes.
Would that be...
Do we?
Yeah, I can change it to unassigned.
It really is not assigned for capital replacement.
I would agree with you. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off where you were going there, Michael. It just kind of hit me. If they want to make changes, now's the time to do it. They can accept it with the proposed changes still, and you can just send me a new copy. We don't have to represent it with one little line change.
Right.
Yeah.
So we're going to change it to unassigned?
Yes.
For capital expenditures?
No, just unassigned.
Just unassigned.
Just unassigned.
We're going to disassociate it with capital expenditures, and hopefully by next year we'll have something to put in capital expenditures. Will we adopt a policy
sure
to do that?
Sure, we will. Okay.
I can send you an email tomorrow, Michael.
What's that?
I can send you an email tomorrow, Michael.
Okay, I made a note, so.
Thank you, sir.
I'll change it down the
side.
Thank you. So, page 12, you know, here's your statement of activities on the modified accrual basis. Basically, third line from the bottom in the general fund column, you have revenues and excessive expenditures of, you know, almost $402,000. All three funds of Measure A debt service had revenues and excessive expenditures. Management is doing a good job of managing the resources.
This year. 40 minutes ago, Michael.
So that is all I wanted to present in these financial statements.
Mm-hmm.
Behind these are the notes to the financial statements. Talks a lot about your OPEB, your net pension liability, accounting policies, mm-hmm. your capital assets. You do have some debt loans there. It gives you amortization schedules, the payment schedules for those. If you have any questions, you can always contact them.
Okay, let's see.
And then at the end, there's a budget actual for just the general fund.
So page 32, there's a statement that is labeled unaudited in an annual audit report.
So this page is unaudited because budget numbers we cannot audit. Budget numbers are estimates.
Okay.
Yeah. So the actual numbers, we can verify.
That was budget only.
Right.
Basically. Okay, cool. Thank you.
The MD&A, which is in the front, also is an audit document. So now there's just one other thing, a management report.
Mm-hmm.
The management report, we look at the district's internal controls to mitigate error and fraud to the district's assets. And if we find any areas for improvement, then we mention them here.
Mm-hmm.
So we do have a current year observation, and there are some prior year observations as well.
I do have a question on that. On the on number one, bank reconciliations, in our response, we say during the transition system, several credits were applied. Were we able to resolve why were they applied? Were they applied rightfully, or was it an error because of their transition?
It was. I don't think it was an error. We're still actually working on resolving them. We've resolved it from an accounting perspective, and we've been working with an accounting consultant to kind of come in and do that. And when I say credits, I mean ultimately the county thought that we had $7,000 more than we thought we had. A lot of it did have to do with this transition primarily. I mean, they were posting deposits dated 6/30 as late as October. And it was just, yeah, exactly. I mean, it was really, I spent so much time trying to track it down to the penny that eventually I decided I'm gonna spend more than $7,000 worth of my time trying to reconcile through all of this. And in talking with Michael, we just kind of looked at it as a irreconcilable difference ultimately in the district's favor, but we are going to get to the bottom of it, and that's one of these, is just running monthly reconciliations between the county's financial accounting system and ours. When they did transition, they also moved funds from several years, cleared out warrants that had never been cashed from years prior. There was just a lot of funky things going on. Some were very easy to track, some were not, because they were done in like lump sum automated transactions of just moving things from SAP to Munis. Some entries were made in SAP while other entries were made in Munis. Yeah, it was definitely part of the challenge of the county moving over and us moving over, so trying to reconcile, in short, three different accounting systems.
So that's in progress, but hopefully at some point.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, like I said, we've been through some recommendations on, we're working with a consultant right now, who's actually came in one day to kind of already get us started. Who works with Marin Fire, works with LAFCO, works with some other agencies, is familiar with Munis, and is familiar with QuickBooks. At least as familiar as anybody can be with Munis at this point in time.
And then the capital assets and compensated absences, what's the story on that, that's prior to your observations?
The capital assets.
I see what you're
saying. Prior general manager, you know, we always tell him to raise the threshold. He has a big spreadsheet with all these little assets on there.
Right.
And he said it's a lot of work, mm-hmm. but you can raise the threshold.
So that's what we'll be doing now. So that should.
Tonight, I think we're going to.
What does compensated absences mean in terms of capital assets?
So compensated absences are not capital assets.
Compensated. That's payroll.
They're vacation.
Vacation. Right. Yeah.
Right. They're two unrelated things, but related to the balance sheet in general. Michael, who doesn't know, there's actually a resolution on the table tonight to increase the whole capitalization depreciation policy that will increase it to $5,000. So next year, this would obviously be completed.
Cleaned up.
And done. And then ultimately, because we had SAP for so long, we had very little, if any, control over the balance sheet, as I kind of stated in here, specific to our thing. So they weren't recording accrued absences, compensated absences within the balance sheet as a liability and relied solely on the audit to represent the year-end balance sheet. Once this is done and approved, one of the things we'll be working with our consultant on is bringing the QuickBooks balance sheet into compliance with this and then monitoring it on a regular basis moving forward so we can actually have a balance sheet specific to this district that we have complete control over.
Okay.
Irv?
Starting on page 4, there were recommendations and then responses, and in some cases status reports. You were just talking about the second one, which deals with the raising the capitalized threshold, but the first one, the response, I don't perceive that it addresses the real the recommendation, and it seems like it needs to be taken to completion somehow. But I don't, a statement saying, you know, the district, I don't know, doesn't have the funds to hire an outside accountant, but we've solved this by doing the quarterly reconciliation or something. It seems like it left that one up in the air.
What I can tell you, Irv, is at the time this response was filed, we hadn't done that yet. But we have since forth brought in a consultant to kind of help us with these reconciliations, who is an outside person who can prepare the reconciliations that I can then review. Which will give us a little bit of a separation from church and state, so to speak, on that, which will be nice. I have revised the response. But yeah, I mean, these are, you know, observations in the course of the audit that I don't think are necessarily intended to be solved before they get presented. I don't know, Mike, what you tell me.
What's the effective date of this document? Is it June 30th?
June 30th.
Or when we're looking at it to adopt it?
Probably January 8th or something.
As far as, you mean when it was produced? Yeah, here it was drafted as of 1/23.
Okay, I just like I said, you've answered my question, but it isn't in here.
Right.
Should this be updated to current events is my question.
Since we can change.
If you want to change it, you can.
Yeah, I can easily give Michael an updated response.
So how does number one differ from number four? Because number four talks about bank reconciliation.
So we've had this issue for a number of years. And so now it's different this year than in the past because now you have QuickBooks system. So I really commend Eric for bringing that on and taking that challenge. Tom never did that, which was fine. That was his style of working. But there were issues with the bank reconciliation then. I think that was only related to a payroll account. But the other one now is, in previous years, your county fund account, your money is kept with the county, tied right in. There wasn't a reconciliation that was required because we used their records. So now you have QuickBooks, and all the information is flowing through QuickBooks, but there are some differences between the county's records and the district's records, and that has to be reconciled. So it's an additional reconciliation that needs to be done.
Right, but then if we're going to have this consultant come in and reconcile that stuff, doesn't it take care of item one and four?
It will. It'll take care of both of them, yes.
Okay, so can we then update our response to number one and four by saying consultant will come in, reconcile, and then we're done?
Or have been hired to come in and do that.
And I think these are slightly different because one was always, four was always specific to the payroll account.
What I'm interested in is the fact that we are addressing outstanding issues, and by you hiring a consultant to reconcile it for us, we have effectively taken care of number four and number one.
Perhaps. Is this person intended to be an ongoing consultant, or is this a migration to QuickBooks, fix up things, and then go away consultant?
Yet to be fully determined. So it depends on what exactly is involved with the reconciliation process between Munis and QuickBooks. There's definitely a small amount of funding that has been put into the budget for each of the past several years for an accounting consultant. I don't envision the need to exceed that, and I think that we're talking about ultimately a few hours a month.
Okay, so this could be an ongoing thing.
It could be.
Mm-hmm. Okay, fair enough. And this gives us separation of responsibilities that we don't have in-house.
Correct.
Essentially, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So that would be part of our addressing number two, which is the written accounting and administrative procedure manual that would mention the outside eyes of the consultant providing
Sure. Hopefully the consultant will do number one and then
four.
Number four and number three.
Now there's also the second item, number one. The prior year observation, number one.
Well, the current year observation, number one, the prior year observation, number four.
Right.
And then prior observation number three.
And I wanted to speak to prior year observation number one. It says this recommendation has not been implemented. Shouldn't that say this recommendation is being sent to the board for action to be current?
We can change it.
Because that is on the agenda tonight.
Okay.
So I think after tonight, Eric might...
It actually does say that to a degree where it says management agrees with raising the capitalization threshold for equipment to 5,000 and will make this recommendation to the board who are responsible for approval of such policy.
No, but then there's a line for status and it says the recommendation has not been implemented. On the next page, on five.
Well, I see what you're saying.
And it just seems that maybe ought to be the recommendation is scheduled to be implemented tonight.
So it seems like after tonight, Eric will be able to update this document to reflect the most current status?
But isn't...
I don't list the status, I only provide a response. You have to ask Michael.
Isn't this whole report as of June 30th, 2016? So the reality is, as of June 30th, 2016, this recommendation has not been implemented.
Correct.
Well, that was my first question.
Yeah.
And I didn't quite get that definite answer.
This report is dated...
January 23rd.
It would be dated when we finalize it, so yeah. It'll be as of the date.
So then it ought to be updated to be where we really are.
We can update that.
So after tonight, we can just say it has been implemented.
Yeah.
If we vote to implement it.
Yes.
All those in favor? No.
Okay, fair enough. At the beginning of the entire document, you talk about your audit, looking for any, you know, red flags about fraud or erroneous entries, et cetera, et cetera. What I came away with is you found no material weaknesses. Did I get that right?
That's correct.
Okay. And at the end, we have a proposal to adopt a policy that specifically addresses fraud, and that is a recommendation as well. Is that correct?
That is, yes.
Okay. So one of our esteemed board members has been working on finally publishing and or bringing up to the 21st century some of our policies, and that is certainly high on the list, and we'll start looking at that as well. So appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike.
Yeah, that was one, to your point, Jeff, on prior year number two, where I specifically asked if on status we could put in progress on ongoing.
Mm-hmm.
To specifically note that it is being addressed, you know, in bite-sized pieces as can be digested.
Can I also read into this consultant that's coming in to help and this and that there'll be no request for a board member to come in and oversee, or is that still something that you want to consider?
It certainly can be considered. You know, I mean, if a board member wanted to come in, I know, I've talked to other kind of board members in the past about if they want to just review what I've done simply on the payroll account with mm-hmm. Wells Fargo, if they mm-hmm. wanted to look at it. It's just never really come to fruit. I mean, it certainly can be done.
Okay. Well, I mean, you know, if it fixes one of the, the statements therein, I'm certainly willing to come in and serve that.
Other people have made that same suggestion. It's on me to just follow up and say, hey, this has been completed. Come
okay.
on down and take a look at it anytime you want.
Okay, fair enough.
Is that it?
I'm good.
We are?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think so.
Thank you very much,
thanks.
Michael.
Thank you very much.
Really appreciate it.
Yeah. It says we're supposed to accept the reports.
Well, we're going to call for an acceptance as corrected.
I move that we accept the auditor's report as and statements, the complete year-end audit with certain potential amendments to the notes, but otherwise as delivered.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thanks. Michael, I'll send you something tomorrow.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Happy Valentine's Day. Tell your wife I'm sorry.
It's okay.
And now we have the fiscal year 16-17, second quarter budget to actual, variance report.
Well, I think I would just start and ask if there's any questions.
I do, of course.
Okay.
it's a formatting issue, I guess. There, for example, on page 4, there's a whole bunch of zeros. Is that something that we can... Jeff is laughing. Okay, so that's a silly question.
No, it's not a silly question. It's a question he already asked me.
Okay.
Is why. Yes, in short, to make it to answer that, yes, I can get rid of it. This comes from one report that is produced through QuickBooks, and then I export it into Excel just because I can get the ease of printing and it comes out cleaner. I do have the ability to break it down not only the way it's currently shown, but solely by department, and when you break it down solely by department, it's just a matter of running the report for each department and then for the total and then putting all of those together.
Thank you. So that sounds great. On page 10, fire department, the service contract revenue, CSA 13 contract revenue, and paramedic reimbursement. Is that a timing issue?
Yeah, it was actually one of the things for CSA 13 that I listed in the variance notes.
Not the CSA, the emergency response fees. Sorry, service contract revenue, emergency response fees, and paramedic reimbursement.
Paramedic reimbursement was a placeholder we put in there. Should we ever get paramedics, they're going to be, Sarah will be giving Marinwood money. So we listed it now as a placeholder. And
all right, so we're never expecting, obviously. Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Yep. The emergency response fees I'm working on with a woman named Joyce who does billing at Santa Fe.
So that's just timing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Service contract revenue is also a timing setup. I've actually sent requests for payment to, this is primarily entirely the county farm. So this is the Marin County Office of Ed as well as the county for servicing what is known as County Farm Juvenile Hall, as well as some park maintenance buildings and CSA 13. They contract for fire with those. They pay it in one installment typically in the towards the fourth quarter. I've sent them a request for payment, so hopefully we can move those up the chain a little bit.
On page 11, consultant fees. Was that for fact finding?
No, those are GASB 68 reports, for the most part. That's also where some accounting is written into as well.
Mm-hmm. And then the telecom, phone, internet, cable, we're paying $8,000 for the bundle for the fire department?
That includes like phone phones and that includes a lot more than just your one phone.
Is there any way for us to try to bundle the whole thing and maybe get a
discount? They actually get free cable next door because they're heroes. it's actually not that bad. there's a lot to it.
Are we heroes or are we heroes?
Definitely quotation marks.
I'll take either. I'm good with either.
And then the awards, I'm sorry, I completely missed the vote on the awards. What awards did we?
So we do a year-end dinner every year at McGinnis for the paying volunteers, and they give out the firefighter of the year, volunteer of the year, and also there was a nice plaque given to everyone's favorite captain who recently retired.
Huh.
But that, we're done with that one.
Yeah.
There was a plaque?
It's a big plaque, too.
In the recreation area office supplies, $3,500 for website design. Do we not have a professional fees account?
No.
We do not.
No, not for this purpose, and it wasn't pre-budgeted either because we were planning on doing it. The $3,500 wasn't entirely for a website. I believe...
What page are you on? I'm sorry.
I'm just looking at the explanations.
Right, I believe $2,500 or so of it was for the website design, and then we also had to buy new credit card readers to be used with the registration software, and that was about $1,000 of it.
Okay, does it make sense to have a professional services account at some point in time?
Sure.
I mean, but what I'm hearing is we do not have one.
We would put it under consultant.
Okay.
That is the account right now that captures the fees that we pay for website.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So it's not just paper and paper clips and pens and staples and things like that.
It's like 21st century office supply.
Virtual office supply. Yeah. Great. Okay. Please tell me that one of the lions didn't get on our playground equipment and break it. Why are they reimbursing us for playground?
Well, that's good that you bring that up, because I do have some things I'll bring up at the end. They didn't reimburse us for playground. It actually could go into donations as well. They made a donation towards the replacement of playground parts that we had to replace anyway. It was coded in this point in time as an expense reimbursement. It certainly could be moved to donations.
Okay.
It was an expense that we had that they helped us cover.
So it went, that's the 17,000?
No, they certainly didn't do that much.
Oh, no, because I was looking at the, I guess it was the expense reimbursements on the first page, just being, it's budgeted for 500 and we've got.
So that line actually kind of ebbs and flows. Silly, but when we get a lot of reimbursements for all of our like class programs and stuff like that, Paula puts the money into there.
Oh.
It sits there for a little while, and at the end of the quarter, I'll reconcile it. I'll take the money out.
And put it in its right place.
Contra revenue and all that kind of stuff.
It's a sweep account.
Okay, sorry.
To a degree, and there was another line that went in there that was actually a large chunk. It was a $5,000 check that Shane was able to secure from the Tennis Association that was put towards the repaving work that we did to the tennis courts, which could also fall under donations, because essentially that's what it was, but it was a conditions donation for an expense we had to incur anyway. Same thing with the Lions. So it kind of naturally went into expense reimbursements. It could just as easily go into donations. We did make several kind of journal entries when we reviewed this. I left that one there for the time being, but I certainly had the thought that it would look nice under donations. Mm-hmm. So it seems like we are getting levels of donations. And then to Carolyn's point, a lot of chunks that go in there for CPR classes, primarily when we are contracted to go offsite and teach CPR for another group. It costs us money to go through, buy all of the stuff to do it, primarily the certifications from Red Cross, so on and so forth. And then we get paid for that. That money tends to go into expense reimbursements.
There was a comment, I think, throughout about general insurance, and it appears that what you're trying to say is that general insurance is paid all up front at the beginning of the year, and we seem to be quite under budget for that.
For P&L? Yeah, I looked at that, and I'm not 100% sure why it was budgeted on that level. It was historic, but I do think it's going to come in under.
Okay. All right. I'm a little confused by unemployment insurance under the park department based on the first 7K of it per employee in the calendar year.
Yes, the way unemployment insurance is billed is it's $7,000. It's the first $7,000 earned per employment in the calendar year. So all park employees had already earned their first $7,000 in quarter three and quarter four of last year, which, to make it sound more confusing, is quarter one and quarter two of the calendar year. So in quarter one and quarter two of the fiscal year, all of those park guys, from an unemployment standpoint, had already paid their dues. The district had. You will see that line jump now for quarter three because we're back at the beginning of the calendar year.
How nice.
Along those lines, when the district filed the 940 form for the payroll, how much of an increase was there?
I don't have that answer right in front of you.
Because I know for my clients, it was humongous. That's the difference between the state unemployment insurance and the federal, because the state borrowed all the money, so it's up to employers to pay the difference to make up that loan.
Our UI rate actually has gone down.
No, the FUTA, F-U-T-A, but the federal unemployment insurance it skyrocketed. I mean, mine just, and I have just a couple of employees, went way over what we were paying to the state. So there was a chunk liability due January 31st.
Yeah, we don't have any such requirements. I'd have to
look really?
At it, but it's our state SUI went down. The rate did.
Okay.
based on what we had in our reserve account and previous claims?
No, that's for the new calendar year. I'm talking about 940 is due on for 12/31. It's calendar.
Right, I have to look at those.
Payroll period. Yeah, I'm just curious because it was so large for all my clients.
I'd have to look at it.
Okay.
I have one more question on page 12. There are a couple of line items with an asterisk next to it.
Yes, what that means is that's an asterisk within the chart of accounts that ultimately when we created this chart of accounts within QuickBooks and started trying to title them, it was recognized that one line is being used for multiple purposes across departments.
Because it doesn't make sense.
That is why, that you're right, pool maintenance and hydrant maintenance, okay, I guess they both touch water. But why you're, small tools in open space or... my favorite one, I can't remember where it is, but was marketing and vending or something like that, I think. So these are me trying to give it something that makes sense. And eventually, yes, as we move in to create the next budget, where we're not kind of relying upon importing the county's things, we can add GL lines and start to break some things out that make more sense.
Last question for me.
Okay.
The rental income for the pool and picnic and the community center.
Mm-hmm. What page do you want to know?
The first page. We've collected more than 50% for the fiscal year, just up through December 16th, it says, right?
Well, this would be through December 31.
We'll probably get more than budgeted because...
Well, I'm just curious as to if this is prepaid or...
At this point in time, no. There's not a lot of things that are booked out that far in advance.
Okay.
A couple of the resulting, and I would definitely tip the cap to Shane, we built a second
right,
rental area in the pool. We added another rental area out by the playground. And then keeping in mind the primary rent... The way summer works, I mean, from July 1st on, you have more of the summer opportunity than you have building up.
No, I know. Indian summer was pretty nice, too.
Right.
Yeah, but rentals are up in general.
Okay.
But even the community center rentals were up by, like, I looked on a yearly basis because that's just how I monitor things, and we were up, like, $18,000
in okay.
the prior. And we just raised fees on everything for non-residents.
Okay. Cool.
As long as the park doesn't wash away, we'll be in good shape.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, we can certainly look at that for a budgeting thing for next year, too. I would like to think it is under-promising and over-delivering.
Well, I'd rather under-promise than...
Mm-hmm. Stop raising expectations.
Yes.
One of the things that we spoke about when we were looking at the capital reserves and, fixed asset replacement spreadsheet, which I think we should be looking at least on a quarterly basis and chewing it up, was I remember very specifically Shane's comment about, well, there's always something that happens. There's always something that breaks, unanticipated.
Mm-hmm.
I think under maintenance of park equipment and accounts like that, we should probably start budgeting something exactly for that reason.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's always something that's gonna break. So.
What should we label this account? There's always something
missing. We'll just call it Shane's slush account.
Well, I think Jeff is actually kind of suggesting
just
raise the budget.
A little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, just put something in there. Cause,
I would have disagreed.
If nothing happens that year, wow, terrific. We have a windfall
mm-hmm.
that we can place towards actual reserve or fixed asset replacements.
Cool.
I think that's all I've got.
I'm good.
Good? Everybody good?
I do have a question. Within fire, right now and this is actually going to probably be, I guess we could implement it as a practice this year, but I would assume more going into next year. 4850 payments are applied as contra expense to salaries, which to some degree makes salaries appear a little deflated. If you look at the fire salaries line on page 11, it shows only 34.49. That's because 4850 reimbursements have been put into there. I am curious of the board's thoughts on continuing that practice, which the district has kind of always done, or adding a line for specifically for 4850 reimbursement.
What is 4850?
4850 is workers' comp. It's what the district gets reimbursed from our workers' comp carrier for industrial injury leave.
I'm all in favor of making sure that we highlight that and make it its own line item.
I agree.
I would think. Now, second question, as its own line item, would you like it listed under expenditures yet still as a contra? Or would you like to put it into revenues?
It's not revenue.
No.
It's a contra expense account.
It's a contra expense account to insurance.
I would agree. Well, ultimately, it comes from insurance. It's not 100% of the portion of salary. It is a lower percentage of salary, and there is legislative caps that are put onto it. That's the most that can be paid out per individual per year. But it can go, I can create a contra line showing income coming in, offsetting an expense.
Does this have an effect on the 100%. Payroll?
Does it have an effect on payroll? No. It doesn't have an effect on payroll in that we pay the full salary.
And then we get a reimbursement.
And then we get reimbursed from our insurance. Right.
For the insurance, though.
No, it's insurance reimbursement for the salary that we pay out.
It just goes back into the general fund.
Yeah.
Right. You're exactly right. And I mean, it does affect our workers' comp rates.
Okay.
I'm expecting a decent increase in our experience modification factor for next year. I haven't received it yet.
Everybody's is going
up. I would assume it's going to go up.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's based on 3-year averages.
Okay.
21 thing doesn't go up.
It actually went down for this fiscal year.
Gas prices.
But,
no problem.
Yeah, there you go. Okay, that was one of my questions is, it just seemed like it might be a more appropriate place to put it.
Should
list
have its
full
own
amount that's gone out for salaries and then showing the contra expense as.
Yeah, because there's no reason.
I can create a separate line for it.
Okay.
And even, I'll figure out the best place to put it.
Okay.
Thank you.
I guess we should move on then, since that's the last.
Any public comment?
Okay, the consent calendar.
I would like to propose a change to the minutes. Under board members, it's President Bill Shea, I believe.
No,
of January. Yeah. Kind of.
Sorry about that.
No.
I'll change it.
What is the fire consulting on page 635? It's $1,075.
XMR?
Yeah, XMR.
Oh, that was, we had to pay off last year's website. The fire department's own website from last year, which we no longer have to pay.
And music licensing fees?
Yeah, it's just licensing fees.
Because if you're a entity playing music to the public, you have to pay a licensing fee to the music.
Royalties.
Yeah, otherwise
pretty much.
So that's like music in the park kind of thing?
Yeah, and you can't even play, you know, CDs.
Taylor Swift or whatever.
Oh my god.
And they actually do come after you.
And thank God we don't have an elevator.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, that's why every elevator music song sounds just enough like something that you can recognize it, but it's not a perfect copy.
Have the preschool kids sing some stuff, record it, and play it. I mean, honestly.
We'll have to pay them royalties.
Yeah, you know?
We used to have multiple companies that would come after us.
Remember Brick and the Wall?
Oh, yeah. It's okay. Just another one.
Marin, yes. You're all firefighters, the union dues. Do we pay union dues?
Yes, but we also take a deduction.
We get reimbursed quarterly.
We pay them, they are a employee deduction from payroll.
Thank you.
100% or?
Yeah.
Yeah, 100%, we don't pay any other union dues, and it's captured in, if you look at any one of the payrolls at the bottom, benefits withholding, it's part of that.
Okay.
And then fire equipment paid to US Bank in the amount of $1,241.
I would say it's probably a set of turnouts.
That's why I keep coming to the fire commission meetings, because I have a lot to learn. That's all from me.
720 Cal Wine Tours, once again, $11,671. I'm assuming that's taking kids for winter programs, but it's labeled summer. What is it?
It's summer.
Summer?
It's our deposit.
What?
We have to book.
For next summer?
For next summer.
So this is a prepaid expense?
No, not really, because we split it up half this fiscal year, half next fiscal year, that's all.
Okay. Summer was what confused me. I was going to say, somebody is sending their bills by, you know, wagon train or something.
We have to start putting our deposits down and planning for summer.
Registration opens tomorrow.
Registration opens tomorrow.
Okay, oh, right, I know, yeah, the last rainy, the last non-rainy day. So, yeah, okay. Just the way the power conversion crumbles.
I don't have any further questions.
Me neither.
Anybody else? A call for a vote then? I thought we had a motion.
I move to approve consent calendar.
Second.
Second, okay.
No further discussion.
No further discussion, any, the public, yeah. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I abstain, since I wasn't at the meeting.
That one will be a long.
Public comment, open time for. District manners, matters, sorry.
District does matter, come on.
Update from the ad hoc committee to review policies and procedures.
I don't really have anything to discuss, it's just that we should approve the capitalization and depreciation and the reserve policy. I do have a suggestion, and I would be interested in your feedback. For the capitalization and depreciation policy, I put in the attachment A 15 years for modular buildings for depreciation and 30 for general buildings, but I think it would be more reasonable to do 30 and 50. Just because we have 15.
Are we following IRS guidelines?
Is that IRS guideline?
No, well, I would say general buildings, 30 year would be commercial, because
so
that's 20.
Is appropriate?
Yeah, it's actually more than 30 for commercial property.
So that's what I'm saying, it should be more than 30.
It should be 40.
According to the audit, we are listing 50 within the audit. There was a depreciation schedule somewhere there.
Oof.
It's on page 21, and it lists buildings 30 to 50, improvements 10 to 20, equipment 5 to 40, and infrastructure 10 to 50. And
that's what we've got now, right?
Well,
current.
The buildings, the modular building is way below.
Yeah, well, that's like a trailer, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's probably appropriate.
So you good with what it says now, 15 and 30?
I don't see any reason to change.
I don't see any reason to change that.
Speak to me, thank you.
Okay, under the capital depreciation policy, donations are mentioned. I think the term should be fair market value. They should be evaluated or valued on fair market value. And due to our conversations, they should be depreciated. And that was something I think we left in draft form. saying likely not to be depreciated?
I left the line out about not to be depreciated.
Oh, you did? It's not in there?
Donated capital assets should be reported at their estimated fair, now to say fair market value, at the time of acquisition, plus ancillary charges if any.
Oh, okay, cool, all right. I must have looked at the whole version or something. Okay, cool, that's nice.
But you're saying they should be depreciated.
Absolutely.
And we're not saying it. So we should add after if any, comma, and should be depreciated.
Okay, I don't think that that's necessary.
Donations are indeed supposed to be depreciated.
Yes.
Now, they can be, we can write that, let's put it this way. If we receive a building, somebody drops a building on our property, and it's been almost fully depreciated, we can carry it on our books as fully depreciated, and then there's nothing to worry about. But generally speaking, the letter of the law says that you're supposed to put it on your books at fair market value, whether it's been fully depreciated or not, and you need to depreciate it per the useful life or whatever the capital reserve.
Right. Well, once it comes to us, I mean, we haven't depreciated it or not. I mean, we have to assign a fair market value.
We have to assign a fair market value.
So it can be false depreciated?
Yeah, I mean, I guess when I read this personally, I see donated capital assets should be reported underneath the column, you know, talking about the policy of capital assets. If you'd like further clarification, I could put donated capital assets should be reported and depreciated at their estimated fair market value.
Remind me, was this statement right after the statement about land is not depreciated?
It was within that section.
Okay. I would just make sure that it gets included in the paragraph in such a manner that it's very obvious that those assets will be depreciated.
Okay, so okay. If I have it say donated capital assets should be reported and depreciated at their
fair market value.
Yeah, at their estimated fair market value.
Yep.
I have a comment or question about the attachment A at the bottom. There's three categories of vehicles, and one are fire vehicles. The way it's labeled, it seems like where you have autos, vans, and trucks, the first line, you depreciate that 10 years, but the chief's vehicle would be depreciated at 20 years. I think you meant probably fire apparatus. Maybe that's a better word there. Because like, if they get a new utility vehicle, which category does that fit into?
Sure, it's more like a truck. Yeah.
So fire engines?
Or maybe fire engines.
Fire apparatus makes
fire
sense.
Fire engines, fire apparatus.
But then I have a question under that last section, fire apparatus. We used up four engines in 56 years. So it's about, 14 years per engine. But you have a 20-year thing, Sean, here.
Typically 20 years for a type 1 is what could be 15 to 20. We got about 23 out of our previous type 1, mm-hmm. The one we just replaced, so I think 20 is a fair number.
Yeah.
I mean, it just depends how hard they're used. San Francisco Fire gets about 8 years out of it. They appreciate it. Trying to do it to replace them every five. So, but with our use, and I think 20 is a fair number.
A bit better.
I have one other comment. On the next to last paragraph, I'd like to change the word deleted to or otherwise removed from service.
The next to last paragraph.
Last sentence.
Last sentence. Instead of...
No sold or otherwise removed from service.
Mm-hmm. Deleted sounds like a booking entry.
Got it.
That's all I had on that.
Any other comments?
Just to clarify, under vehicles, we want to change it from fire vehicles to fire apparatus.
Mm-hmm.
Apparatus. Well, I guess we'll call for a vote then.
Or you need a motion?
Or how about a motion?
I want to approve the capitalization depreciation policy as amended.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And then we have a resolution.
So we just passed the $5,000 limit, yeah?
Done.
Yeah.
With amendments, I will make those changes tomorrow and change the wording up top to say adopted by Board of Directors and slap it on the website.
Great.
We have a resolution 2017-01.
And I move to approve the resolution.
Second.
All those in favor?
Well, hold on. We need to, if there's any questions or comments about it.
I don't have any questions.
I would, just as an FYI, I ran this through County Council for legal review. They didn't have any legal concerns. They referred me to the county administrator's office, my primary concern being the fact that we do, and for the foreseeable future, will continue to have, need to take out a dry period loan. I want to know any impact on this. County administrator's office didn't see any impact or concern with that need and the district still having prudent levels of reserves. They did refer me furthermore to Roy Given in the Department of Finance. I have not heard back from Roy at this point in time, but just in case he had any other little things to chime in, but County Council didn't have any legal concerns and the County Administrative Office didn't see any concerns with it. You can pass it. I don't think that that's an issue. But if Roy was to come back and say, hey, if you have money sitting in a separate reserve account per se, you need to deplete that before you move into, I don't anticipate that happening. I'm just letting you know where it stands right now.
This is the question of if we decided to put capital reserves in an account that earns interest that's other than.
Correct.
We're segregating the account, right?
Okay, so you're waiting for that response.
I am.
Okay.
But establishing a policy has no bearing either way.
Well, we haven't said.
Because we haven't said anybody decided, you're correct. It was more informing the board that this was some solid clarification I wanted from the county.
The only change I'd like to make to it is, rather than saying OPEB would change, I think the term was annually, I'd like to change that to periodically. I think if we are going to ever get to the point where we approve putting funds in the OPEB irrevocable trust account, we should do it at sort of like dollar cost averaging, and that is we don't do it just once a year. We do it in small increments throughout the year.
So would it be under one here? OPEB, the district, as at its discretion, may periodically set aside reserves?
Okay. Yep. As opposed to on an annual basis. Makes it sound like we're doing it once and then we're forgetting about it. And that's something I think we should be looking at periodically.
Every month or two.
Along with financial reviews that are so easy to do in QuickBooks.
Anybody else?
Is that the only change?
That's all I've got.
Okay. Anybody else?
I'll change my motion then.
Would you please?
I move to approve the resolution with changes.
And I'll second that also.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Do we have to read it in the.
Let's pretend.
Yep.
District manager's report?
I didn't put a lot in the report. Obviously, there's a lot in the packet. Just the really quick solar update. I mean, if you want to know what day it's going to rain next, just call me up and ask me what day they have set.
Make sure you schedule the solar.
Ask me what day the next solar thing is. So right now, it's actually set for the day after tomorrow.
Isn't there rain in the forecast?
Yes.
set for the rain after tomorrow?
Rain. PG&E on my last communication, and this was about a week ago, seemed to think that at that point in time, rain was scheduled to come in later in the afternoon, and they were going to try to get this done first thing. I don't know what to say. But, you know, I mean, we're...
Take it as it comes.
It is a priority for PG&E. They're getting a lot of heat. I've got strings coming from all sorts of different levels. The one thing that I can say on solar is, while I haven't gotten the formal communication, I did get a communication today or yesterday from the CSI rebate people who understand the situation and will continue to extend our CSI deadlines until it is, till this is complete.
God.
Until Stephen gives us, well, okay.
Yeah.
Got it.
And then we've already, as part of the Q2 budget actual look, you know, between myself, Chief, and Carolyn, we've already started thinking and preparing for the 17-18 budget. So it seems like we just had New Year's and finished the audit for this one. We're already working on next year. So.
Awesome.
You know, I completely forgot to ask Michael this question. Too bad. So I'm just going to have to ask you guys. After the conversion to QuickBooks, do you feel that the audit was any more difficult or easier or about the same?
Ask me next year.
Yeah, I understand, but how about this year?
Well, everything still kind of came from SAP.
It did?
In a way.
We had to, a lot of the backup documentation we had to pull from SAP, we were able to provide the raw data from QuickBooks that was imported in, but the backup documentation that is attached to that raw data, we weren't able to import from SAP. So, I mean, we were really bouncing across a lot of different systems this year, not to mention some of the moves that have been made in Munis, dated 6/30.
Yeah, okay.
You know, I mean, so, and that is why, in all due sincerity, Jeff, I say ask me next year.
Yeah,
I think next year it'll certainly go much easier, simply because the data will be right there, all the backup documentation will be right there within a click.
Understood.
So on and so forth. I mean, I from one perspective, for the reports that Michael wants, trial balances, things like that generated, yes, that to me was easier, because I was able to produce a much cleaner trial balance that actually made sense when you look at it, as opposed to what SAP produces.
Okay, fair enough.
Some of those documents I had to provide for their review, and then, you know, they went through and said, great, spread this one out and send me that. That part was easier.
Okay. I'll make a note to ask you next year.
Please. Mm-hmm. I kind of look forward to it. I mean, you know, and as part of the budget prep, you know, it's still, QuickBooks isn't going to relieve our need immediately for all of the kind of Excel spreadsheets that we use basically as scratch paper that feed into kind of rolling up into these other. Yeah, right, exactly. So I'm going back and forth on how I'm going to present the budget as we work our way up and through, whether I will present it in QuickBooks or whether I'll present it in the Excel document. Primarily, the only reason I would use the Excel document is we have to do the work in that anyway, and those already kind of feed those old documents as opposed to entering preliminary budget numbers into a budget for QuickBooks.
I'll put in a plug right now. If you can do something like this with your assumptions when you build the budgets,
okay,
then you can have your staff do that as well. So you don't have to do it all. That would be extremely helpful in looking at the budget next year.
Okay.
Something that hasn't existed, you know, for quite some time.
Yeah, great. We can put together some you know, levels of notes and thoughts behind it.
Okay, sounds good. That would be terrific. Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions on the report?
Mm-hmm.
Pray for not a lot of rain on Thursday, please. I'd like to wrap this project up like nobody's business.
Do we have a telephone pole tent handy?
You know, I think it has less to do with them protecting themselves from the rain and more to do with they get called in so many other directions on those days.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So that's it. Let's go on to the fire department. Draft minutes of the fire commission meeting.
Any questions on the minutes? I think I'll touch on everything in the brief chief report.
I have a question on the agenda. I'm not quite sure it went into the minutes. There was something, I think it was under goals and objectives for 2017 about shared services with every entity in the county.
Well, with the Central Marine Training Consortium. The Central Marine Training Consortium, Marinwood, Corvidera, Larkspur, and Kentfield. We all work together and train together and cover each other when this training happens. Currently, we have an agreement with Serafel has an agreement with Larkspur, Larkspur has an agreement with Corvidera, Kentfield doesn't have an agreement with anybody. So there's been some discussion of having one agreement where we can swap personnel if we need to between all agencies. It hasn't really come to fruition like I had thought. And if I had to guess, I think we'll always maintain a separate agreement with Serafel because it involves a different exchange of services, including personnel. And then if there is an overarching five-party agreement that gets into place, we could sign that, but I don't see it happening. I think at best, maybe we could put one together with Larkspur and Corvidera in addition to what we have with Serafel.
Okay, thanks, Chief.
Strictly as it relates to sharing staff.
Sharing staff, correct.
I have another question, and it has to do with, I think it may have to do with the chief, and that is, at the last meeting, I think we made assignments for board members to do certain, you know, ancillary activities, you know, park and rec, liaison, et cetera, et cetera. What we failed to talk about is MIRA. Is the chief our de facto MIRA representative, or should there be someone additional?
I have been for the last few years. I took Bruce Anderson's place when he left the board. Okay. Justin Kai was the alternate.
Okay.
I'm also on the executive committee, so I'm pretty active, and I go to the meetings. I know all the members. If anyone is interested in it and would like to serve as an alternate, I'd be happy to take you to meetings and introduce you to some of the players. It's a pretty interesting group, actually.
I'll volunteer.
Yeah. I mean, there's some great people in the room. I've learned a ton of people.
How often a month?
We schedule monthly, but really we meet about every other month. And it's 3:30 to 4:30 or 5 up at the bottom.
Anytime after May. April, I mean.
Okay.
The end of April. Anytime from May to the end of the year, I'm good.
The February meetings were canceled just because we're pretty far along with everything. But I'm pretty sure we'll meet in March and moving forward. But,
yeah, there's March is...
So you're the alternate. I'll keep you in the loop.
Okay. Cool.
Thanks.
Real quick, in the department, like Eric mentioned, we're starting to work on the budget. The SCBA drawing service, firefighter grant reporting is up to date. I'll have to do some closeout reporting come June. SCBAs are working great. Otis Smith is now in charge of SCBA upkeep and maintenance. I'm going to continue to develop the CERT trailer. I have a list of about $1,000 worth of new supplies to add to the trailer, which the Lions Club will be paying for. I hope to get that accomplished in the next few weeks. I put together a not all-inclusive list of some goals I'm hoping the department to accomplish in 2017. If there's anything in addition you'd like to see, please send me an email. Dan and Dean, our two most recent hires, who are both paramedics, graduate from the new hire academy on Saturday. If anyone's available, I'll send you an email and let you know about the graduation ceremony. It's a nice badge pinning. Chief Gray does a great job putting it together. It's at Serafel City Hall, Saturday at 10. They'll both come to work here the following week. They'll work 3 8-hour days, one on each shift, and then Dean is going to C shift as the third firefighter, and Dan is going to A shift as the third firefighter. You'll have paramedic on A, B, and C shift. They're both great new additions to the department, and I have high hopes and expectations for them.
Awesome.
Very good.
Any other questions?
Thank you for getting that done. That part.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't have a whole lot of control over the other part. Mm-hmm. I've learned it's good to give up control in case you don't.
Anything else?
Yes, indeed. Okay.
Okay, so the date of the next fire commission meeting is March 7th.
Welcome.
Hi. Park and Rec, draft minutes.
No questions.
Any questions? Mm-hmm. Comments from the public?
Wow, what a turnout.
Yeah.
They all have.
So, is the burn issue part of the park and rec report, or is that separate?
That's a separate agenda item.
Okay.
Number three.
We're not quite there yet.
Okay.
We're going to shed first.
So we're done with the draft minutes?
Yeah, no questions.
Then we've got the park maintenance facility replacement initiative.
I included a pretty lengthy memo on it, kind of a brief history, you know, kind of dating back to when the original first part of the building was done based on notes and things that I had found in some of the former district manager's old files, kind of current status and needs. We've been working through it. I would say most importantly, you know, the things to focus on, unless you have questions about what I listed in here, is on the final page of the memo, is we look and move into what needs to happen to keep the initiative rolling forward. I will say, Herb has been a great resource to us in his brief time already here. He's come out, he's met with us out on the site. He was heavily involved in some of the planning that happened back in 2010. And, you know, kind of reviewed and shared with me some of his thoughts on some of these next steps. So thank you, Herb. I certainly appreciated your time in that manner. You know, and the one thing I also did here, and I mentioned it in there, and then, of course, last week was kind of a hectic, chaotic week for myself personally. If you wanted to pass these down, and you don't have to necessarily look at them right now, but these are very loose concept drawings that Victor, one of our park maintenance employees, put together as just looking at, if we were trying to figure out need, functional need of this area and facility. Again, these aren't professionally rendered by any stretch, but I do think that they help to provide a little bit of perspective of what we're looking at. I can walk you through them if you want, or you can kind of look at them and get back to me with any questions. But again, it does help to see. The one thing I would say is the very last page is more of the outside area. Everything other than where it says garage workshop, that's kind of the outside fenced in area. Otherwise, the first two pages are the, you know, the kind of the indoor settings that we've been at.
Is that current dimension?
Yeah, pretty close.
Pretty close.
Yeah.
So,
and then the second page is both.
Let me understand correctly. First, we have to issue an RFP for the architectural drawings, correct?
Once we get to that point.
So what is the first point?
First point I would suggest before we kind of move there is I kind of place these bullets in order and really looking for the kind of community input and community engagement on the process. As put in there, I think there is a, and rightly so, a concern and should be a concerted effort to engage the community as we listen through, listen to any concerns they may have on this, mostly the impacted people who live right on the other side of where we're putting this.
Shouldn't we have something to show them though?
Well, that is something that I certainly put in there too, and that was something that Herb and I talked about that I definitely feel strongly about. But I don't think you're looking at an RFP process or an architect per se as much as you're looking at kind of a visual rendering. Mm-hmm. Just because I believe people do better with visuals, and if you can have some sort of a CAD design that, you know, just very simple, that shows, you know, here's what it could look like over in that area. Herb is very optimistic that we may be able to find somebody to donate those services. I'm not sure, but it would definitely be something I think we should invest in, if not.
Would this go on the website?
It could go on the website, it could go on whiteboards, it could be used as a visual. One of the things I'm proposing is as we get to that point that we certainly should have a separate standalone kind of makeshift public hearing meeting.
Public meeting.
Strictly for this topic. Allow the community to kind of come in, voice any opinions they may have, any feedback they may have. I think the more we can engage and involve the community leading up to everything, the better as it starts to get into the permitting application process. They'll certainly have opportunities to speak there as well.
Given that it's a pretty urgent matter, because the fact that our current shed is still standing is somewhat of a miracle, I think, like, is a month enough of a notice to residents and maybe obtaining a cat visualization to start the conversation? Because I would really want to push it forward as intensely as possible, and I'll be happy to, you know, attend the meeting and help in any way I can, but sadly I'm not versed in cats, so.
To answer your question, I have no idea. I have not begun to look into finding somebody who can put together a visual representation for us. I don't know how long it would take to get somebody or how long it would take to turn it around, or if you might be able to have a little bit of a better insight on that.
I don't know, but so far you're talking about the building. I think the siting of the building is the more critical issue. And a decision has to be made as to where to put it once they figure out where doors are and whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Because the neighbors want it as far away from them as possible, and the county wants it as far away from the creek as possible. And those are incompatible requirements.
Mm-hmm. That much is true.
So, and that's why the sort of the third thing in there is to go, after the community has had their input, is to go to the county and have a consultation to make sure they're not going to shoot down anything we propose before we spend money then on a real plan.
How far away does it have to be from the creek?
Either 50 or 100 feet. There isn't this, you can't meet the strict adherence to the code anyway. And so they have to be convinced that, hey, look where the building is now and we're going to make it better.
Better.
Mm-hmm. And but I don't know how they're going to take that.
So what would you suggest is the first step? Should we meet with the community with just what we have currently with this?
No, I don't think that drawing would do you any good whatsoever.
I don't either.
No, it needs something a little more professionally prepared. And there at least were or are three folks in the neighborhood that I'm aware of that might be able to put something together. One is a former board member, Bill Hansel. And the other is Dave Paoli. I don't know if he would do it. And I don't know if Joe Runco still lives on Idlebury. He's a landscape architect, does site design.
And also a former board member.
Was he on the board also? Mm-hmm. Well, they're just three people I happen to know of who have who could put together some kind of a halfway
rendering.
Either a rendering or a site plan or something that would be a little less amateurish than these drawings.
Would you be able to reach out to them?
I could try.
I think I remember Bill having a lot of opinions back when this came up before.
About how it should look. Just a lot of opinions in general.
A lot of opinions. I remember about this. I remember about the aesthetic. Like there was stuff about the design.
It looked like a night court.
Mm-hmm. I've spoken with Bill to some degree about some of these things. I don't know right now that Bill is interested in doing any pro bono work, but he certainly mentioned that when it got to the RFP process, he could very well be interested in submitting a proposal for it. But I did not get the sense that he is in any way, shape, or form have the capacity to do any pro bono work right now. I don't know Dave Paoli or was it Joe Runco?
Mm-hmm.
I do not personally know either one of them, but my suggestion is if anybody has a personal relationship with them, I would suggest that person reach out to them and potentially set up a meeting that I would love to attend, and we've kind of attacked this in the way that I've attacked capital campaigns for nonprofit before. But if nobody has that relationship.
No, I know all three here.
Okay.
So that would be great if you can reach out, and then maybe you can post on Nextdoor just in case there's a new resident that we are unaware of.
Yeah,
that is cat versed.
An architect or a landscape architect in the community, I don't know.
Okay. Yeah, I don't know.
It's my opinion that we are already late. So, yeah, the sooner the better.
In order to move this along, should we set up some type of a timeline as far as moving this along, both for the public and for county?
Well, I don't know how long the CAD process will take.
Yeah.
And considering that this is a pro bono work, we might be looking at a couple of weeks very well. And then, you know, given people's schedules, I would say at least 2 weeks of advance notice about the meeting would be a fair thing, even though the turnout will be probably minimal.
So we want to continue this at least for the next meeting with updates.
We'll have someone on board working on drawings.
By then.
And we could, I don't know, the board tonight could say, once we know a date, you know, for sure that we will have the drawings, we could then schedule. And I propose calling it a workshop, not a public hearing.
I would love to have a workshop happen before the next board meeting.
But we have to have some kind of drawings.
We would have to have some kind of.
The other thing is we could just hire somebody to do drawings. I mean, it would be like $1,000 to $2,000, I think.
Probably.
And so, because I mean, I think, and I have a list of people. I mean, I paid somebody $1,800 for drawings for a, you know, a building last year. I mean, if there's a budget for this project, right? I mean, it's great if we can find somebody to donate it, but this is just also part of the project that's just going to have to happen. So it seems as though perhaps to get it started, especially if we want to do it started quickly, you know, give ourselves a timeline to check out pro bono and then move on to hiring somebody.
I would agree. That was going to be my comment of if we, I don't want to spin wheels looking for somebody when at the end of the day, yes, there is a preliminary budget set for this, and this type of work would certainly fall under with that.
Mm-hmm. Great. Good point.
So I will get in touch with Eric about like maybe scheduling a workshop in the main room here.
Give me some time and let's try to track down these drawings and how long it'll take. I mean, it's premature until we know where we're at there to even start looking at.
Because it's also going to take whoever does it a couple of weeks to do it.
It does take a couple of weeks.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, that's on the lucky side. And the cheaper the person, the longer it's going to take.
I would agree with Leo on that. That's been my experience with
that. Irv has pointed out the difficulty with the current, you know, situation and the regulations about where you can place an edifice like this. But I'm also working on pros and cons of different locations. Just to be clear, just so when we do talk to the public, they know that we've made considerations about where else we could put them. Off-site is one. The cons dramatically outweigh the pros, you know, from an efficiency standpoint, from a cost standpoint, it's prohibitive. Other places on district property lack infrastructure, are too visible, would take up space that is otherwise there for public recreation, would have difficulty, would be dangerous in terms of egress, getting vehicles in and out. I mean, they're just.
Oh. Well, I think if you are contemplating open space, you can't do that
no.
by statute.
I'm not talking about open space. I'm talking about anywhere where people who are.
Yeah, I mean, I would say the only district property would have to be somewhere within the park lot.
That is correct.
Or somewhere else along the panhandle there.
You got it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, lack of infrastructure, just, you know, kicking the can down the road.
Mm-hmm.
Those kind of things.
Okay, so it seems like a to-do is for Irv to reach out to these two people, for Eric maybe to look for a paid engagement at some point, somebody might be interested in just providing the services when they're compensated, and hopefully we can get at least the drawings before the next meeting.
That would be.
Okay.
What I'm going to do, I'm going to ask if either of these three guys are interested, and would they consider doing it pro bono? And if they say no, I'm going to ask them, what would they charge us to do it?
Yeah.
So we'll sort of get two steps done.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
But I think also not to be underestimated, there might be new residents in Marinwood or neighboring areas that are versed in CAD and
mm-hmm.
could also be tough, so if you can post it.
And some can still draw by hand, you know. Doesn't have to be CAD, especially for this level of drawing.
My only, I don't disagree with you, Isabella, I just think that posting this to Nextdoor, it could open up a can of worms real fast.
Before we have the workshop?
Before we're even ready to start really addressing this outside of a meeting such as this where we're just kind of talking about it.
Fair enough, I understand. Okay.
Let's see if I can get one of these three guys.
It's on your...
So...
Thank you.
If they say no, I'll say, do they know anybody else in the neighborhood that could help? I'll find a way to mine this.
Very good.
Thank you.
But this will be within, what, a month till the next meeting, or...
Hopefully, we can...
I would say that would be a best-case scenario.
Okay, so we're gonna keep this ongoing then?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Got a new facility out there.
That's outstanding agenda item.
Are we done discussing this then?
Yes.
Is there any public comment? Okay.
Next, we're coming up to the landscape maintenance needs concerning, regarding the berms along Lucas Valley Road and fronting Lucas Valley Estates. We're gonna provide direction.
Yes, so let me give you a little background. Are you all familiar with the berms separating Lucas Valley Road from the estate? Well, Herb can speak to it. He was part of the original engineering and design when those were built, so... And I talked to Herb a little bit about it. But basically, 3 months ago or so, I did an inspection of kind of all of the areas that our landscape crew has been maintaining and found that not much is happening out at the berm site. And I started getting some complaints. In the past, they've done weeding, and that's kind of the extent of it. According to our contract, they're also supposed to be going through there, clearing out any dead debris, pruning bushes, bringing up trees, I think it says up to 6 feet, depending on the height, obviously, a maximum of 6 feet, I believe it said. Mm-hmm. So they weren't doing any of that. So I met with, and I was starting to get complaints as far as not just the weeds, but the fact that nothing's getting pruned. We have several trees that are dead because of the overcrowding. We removed 2 trees during the fall when we did a lot of our tree work around here, but I think there's still 2 or 3 dead trees and other trees that are not doing so good because they're getting encroached by, you know, other bushes and trees. Mm-hmm. So I met with Land Design about 6 weeks ago. They looked at it, their managers came out and said, yeah, it's been neglected. You know, basically I said, just implement, you know, your contract. So they started that, and I believe it was the same day they started. There was an irate homeowner from up there that was very upset that we were pruning the trees and cutting the bushes because he had just recently moved up there, maybe 6 months ago, and was concerned about the, you know, he looked at it as a, not just a sound barrier, but a privacy screen for cars along Lucas Valley Road. He lives right on the corner, and he also lives on a part of the berm where there's not much berm. It comes down, mm-hmm. so it's pretty flat, and it's probably the least planted out of all the areas too. You know, so I kind of explained to him, you know, you guys are basically implementing our contract. So he was upset about it and vented over a week and a half or so. So I went back and forth with him. He's since planted a few trees up there, which in speaking with him, you know, he was asking, can I purchase the berm, my portion of the berm, because, which sounds odd and we wouldn't be able to do, but when that project was initially created, there were some people at the ends of the berm areas that actually did purchase portions of their berm and they take care of their own landscaping and what have you. But at this point, it seems like that ship has sailed because it would be, I don't even think we can sell it, Irv can speak to that. But anyway, I told him that in the past we've had encroachment permits where we've let people, you know, select from 20 different plants that we approve. They sign in, you know, sign up on encroachment so we don't have any liability and they maintain it. We've done it with some medians in the past in front of people's houses. So he kind of just jumped the gun and spent a lot of money and planted some trees. I went and looked at it today. He basically created a screen in front of his house and spent, he told me, $4,000 doing that. So, that being said, I've gotten, the reason we're meeting is I'm getting all sorts of different feedback from the homeowners there. especially the people living right along the berm. Some people saying it's about time you're cleaning it up. Some people saying don't touch anything in front of my house. Some people saying touch this, but don't touch this. Some people saying just touch the Leagues Valley side. So we're kind of at the point where we can't be doing these custom, you know, landscaping jobs for everybody in the community. And everybody else who doesn't live near the berms seems like just wants it cleaned up. So that's kind of where we're at. And I assume these residents here might be.
We're next to the new
owners. We're next to the new owners, and we're on Verbena, 3 Verbena.
Okay.
And we're kind of in a unique property in that the retaining wall and the berm goes half of our property, and then we really don't have anything in front of the other half. So we came to voice our opinion in hopes that when Gary planted the trees in front of our house, Gary, the old gardener, who some people might remember and some not, we've been there 24 years, we were told that they would give us the privacy in 15 to 20 years, because I was saying, Gary, can we get bigger trees? I mean, they were little puny things. And he goes, oh, just wait, Diane, 15 years. So here we're 20 years into it, right?
That's good.
And then we see the crew that's gonna, you know, basically undo, we thought, what we've been waiting 20 years for, which is a nice little screen in front of our house from Lucas Valley Road. Now, yes, our neighbor is very irate, and I know you heard from another neighbor, the Jacksons, I think. She gave me a copy of her email that she sent off. And you know, they don't care, because if you trim the trees 4 feet from the ground, you know, they have a berm and it doesn't affect them. If you trim the trees in front of our house 4 feet from the ground.
Why? Because it slopes down there?
No, yeah, we have nothing.
Yeah.
It's right where the retaining wall.
I know where you guys are at, actually.
Yeah, number 3, retaining wall.
Our park guys made sure to show us your guys' property.
Yes, Marco.
Marco,
I know Marco.
Oh, yeah, Marco. Yeah, Ben knows Marco. Ben and Diane Lynn, and Ben knows Marco. So Marco's like, okay, we won't touch your trees. So we're just here to kind of see what is happening and what's going to go from here, how it's going to move forward, and to request that, because that is our only privacy, the vegetation, we have no other recourse.
But if you want to trim 4 to 6 foot, if it possibly can extend the
retaining
wall.
Yeah, and then that was another question. Yeah. We didn't know, you know, could we extend the retaining, at our expense, the retaining wall to go further? Because it isn't our property, and we don't own the property, and we realize that. And we know that for fire reasons and everything else, you have to keep it clean. Defensible space and all that, but so we're just kind of here to voice our concern and opinion and see what everybody was thinking.
So what they're kind of talking about with the retaining wall is the retaining wall pretty much stops the house before you guys?
No, it stops halfway.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, half of our house is retaining
wall. Basically, there's no berm really in front of their house. There's just the plantings, and you know, if you were to extend the berm down, you could build that berm back up. But that's more of a design. It's probably Irv's fault, so I don't want
to talk. and I would love to know why it was stopped.
What was it
stopped? Yeah, giving her the design
today.
Okay, first off, the berm was put in, the earth berm and the walls, that's the sound barrier. The landscaping doesn't provide any sound attenuation at all. The landscaping on top of the berm is to deal with privacy and visibility and headlights and that sort of thing. The way it was designed, where we couldn't get enough height because the berm wasn't wide enough, that's when we put the retaining wall in on the away from Lucas Valley Road side. It allowed the berm to be higher. And frankly, it's only been 20, how many years since we designed it? So I don't remember the details. But I think the berm came down as you got closer to the intersection to provide some sight distance around the intersection.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense.
And that's what happened. The berm where the backside abutted private property stops at the top of the public ownership stops at the top of the berm, and the backside is maintained by the property owner on which the berm lies. Mm. But when the backside is one of the streets, be it Verbena or Bay Laurel or the ones down at the Bridgegate end, then there's, in most cases, there's a wall to some height, and the berm is maintained on both sides by the district, as was promised as part of the master plan for the project. Now, a speck of history. Back prior to Prop 13, 2007, 2008, when we had two groundspeople in the district, there was this one old man named Dave, and I can't remember his last name. But every year, I don't know what time of year, but I remember every year, he would take a wheelbarrow and a bunch of trimming tools, and he would trim up so that it looked like landscaping all of Lucas Valley Road frontage from just south of Las Colinas to just, or east of Las Colinas to just west of Huckleberry. He cleaned the whole thing up, and it looked landscaped. And he'd throw all the brush out in what's now the bike path, and I think the county would clean it and take it all away for him. And Prop 13 came, he was let go, and that hasn't been maintained as landscaping ever since, as far as I know.
No.
So in 40 years, it grew the way it looked till the county decided they had to do something. So that's one way you could landscape, is the way the county did. Come through with tree trimmers and their flailing machine and just wipe everything out back from the road. And I don't think anybody cares for that method very much.
So, especially if they live on Appleberry.
Yeah. So the second way you could landscape is what I think was originally intended with the berms on Lucas Valley Estates. And I frankly don't understand why you need to trim up from the ground 4 feet or 6 feet or whatever, because that just opens the sight lines up.
Right.
So that seems
a vegetation management thing.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's actually supposed to be 10 feet or one third of the height of the tree.
Mm-hmm.
But this is a landscape
area.
It isn't a wildland area. It looks like a wildland area. But it's supposed to be a landscape area. Now, it seems to me there's a third way that landscaping could be maintained. And that is just to shape up the trees that are there.
Mm-hmm.
The fellow at One Verbena, when I went to see him, he said he knows all about trees. He was in forestry or something at one time. I don't know if that's you, but I never saw him. We talked on the phone.
No, they're not here.
Okay.
I
talked to his wife, but he wasn't there. And I talked to him on the phone. In any event, he says once you cut the redwood trees up, they'll never grow anything new below that cutting, probably because the sun's gone from it. And you can see that on the older redwood trees on Lucas Valley Road. Mm-hmm. But it's my experience, at least in my yard, that if you trim up oak trees, they sprout back out again. So I'm thinking that the logical thing to do is, unless there's some overriding reason why we shouldn't, that we don't trim up from the bottom so that there's a clear spot underneath, but that we shape all the trees that are there so it looks like landscaping and not like a wild area, and also is safe because it's encroaching on the bike lane on Lucas Valley Road, and at least according to one of the emails that Eric sent out today, it's encroaching on the public road on the other side. I don't know, I guess it's Verbena because that's where that fellow lived. But it seems like it could be cleaned up. The redwood trees would be more challenging maybe because you go and just clip the ends off the branches that are overhanging. That may be a problem. But the oaks could surely be shaped and some of the other trees. And so it would look nice. It wouldn't make it so you could see through. If it did, it would grow, probably fill in. If they were to trim them now, it would fill in the spring.
Okay.
Part of the issue there, too, is it is getting fairly overgrown, and a lot of the smaller plants and things are getting snuffed out and are basically dying.
Mm-hmm.
Due to lack of room to grow, mm-hmm. There's a couple dead pine trees caught up in through there that really need to come out completely before they wind up laying across Lucas Valley Road, which is a real possibility. It's actually happened a couple times during these last larger rains.
They're that tall?
Some of them are 20, 30 feet tall.
I would imagine pine trees were planted by neighbors. I don't think there were any pine trees on the planting list originally.
There's a lot of volunteer oaks that weren't there but have grown, and now people want us to keep them. But they weren't planted during. I remember The park guys were telling me that the original trees, most of them died or fell over, and Gary went through and replanted a lot of what you see now, along with the neighbors. Maybe you guys can speak to that. So the original plantings were something more similar to what we see out here on the medians, just smaller, kind of ornamental-looking trees. And after those didn't last very long, that's what you kind of see now with a lot of the redwoods. And
yeah, right when when the trees were planted, I don't remember the order, but there was a drought and there was a frost. And one of the things they discovered is the water district had a mandate as to what kinds of plant material you could use. And they had all of Marin County with one pallet. And they didn't realize that it's a little warmer and drier up here than in Mill Valley. And that, I think, has been changed. But I've been after the district for years. Just maintain it a little. Clean, make it look clean and neat.
Yeah. Go ahead.
I want to say thank you for coming.
Thank you guys for doing that.
And thank you for all this background and history and information. Because Shane told me about it at the Brewfest, I took a drive there and looked around, and it does seem that on Lucas Valley side, there are a couple of spots where the branches are so high and so extended that they might potentially affect bicyclists. So I think it should be taken a little bit on the roadside, and you know, also provide a safe kind of, when you turn out of Bridgegate and want to get on Lucas Valley Road, you should be able to kind of see some incoming cars, so maybe clear around the edge. And so on either side of the road, I think a couple of trees could be taken in. There should be dry trees should be removed. Any dry foliage should be removed. But I wouldn't necessarily go as far as providing extreme like grooming or providing a cleanly landscaped area, just because, again, I live on Appleberry, and when the county chopped Lucas Valley Road trees the way they did, I lost privacy. I now, even though I'm at Denbury, I see the street lights here at Miller Creek. And I would hate for neighbors over there to have to see everything that happens on Lucas Valley Road. I totally understand that concern. So in terms of providing a uniform direction to the land design team, I would advocate for, again, removing dry foliage and just taking in the trees a little bit. I also would love for whatever we decide today, for our staff and for Shane to maybe send out letters to everybody affected along that road, and maybe establish a proactive schedule to just, you know, do whatever we decide to do now, once a year, let's say, or twice a year, whatever the schedule would be, so the residents can know what to expect, basically. That's my 5 cents.
It's worth every penny.
Have we been paying them to do this work they haven't been doing?
Yeah. So they've been doing other work, but yeah.
Well, are they paid by time, or are they supposed to accomplish projects?
It's a yearly contract. We're month to month at this point. Because their contract is... But in their contract, it states once a year. They're supposed to go through it. It says pretty specifically the things that they're supposed to do. So they were following with the contract, you know, even after looking at what they had done.
Okay.
They were following what the contract outlined.
But for the first time in how many years?
Since they took over, yeah. Yeah. It's the
That's
first,
third,
yeah.
Third year? Was
this, we're going into the third year?
Second.
Third year.
Yeah.
So let's say if the... if this company goes in and does what they're supposed to do, I'd like to ask the chief, is this berm set up so that it is a fire hazard, i.e. do you have shrubs underneath trees? So if the shrubs go up, the trees are going to...
Yeah, I think if you get rid of the dead and stuff, you'd be fine. If you went along with what Herb's recommendation were, you'd be
okay.
Right. It's not open space, it's not wildland.
Right, right. So just maintaining it should be sufficient, is that correct?
Yeah.
Without doing a lot of surgery on the trees?
Correct.
It seems...
Otherwise, it sounds sort of complicated, you know? Do you have a map that says, these guys have the whole berm, these guys have half a berm, these guys, I mean, you know?
It's really pretty simple, no. Where they only have half the berm is a fence.
Yeah, those ones aren't very complicated. Those people have all planted their regular trees and limbed them up 5 feet. But they put them on both sides, so they're spaced in a way that it still provides, and the berm's tall enough.
Are there private plantings on public land?
I mean, all over the place.
Some of them are going across the crops on your open space.
So we should be rebuilding?
Yeah.
But I would hope that we could make it look like a landscape berm. And you know, if we have to take out some of those volunteers, or at least trim them up so they look like an overgrown weed. Because that's the way they look now.
Well, and to Shane's point too, I think some of those volunteer oaks that have kind of started to go in there, I mean, they're bunched up too close together. They're never going to sprout and turn into prolific oak trees. There's not enough room for them to breathe out that way.
For the root system.
Well, that means you'd be taking some trees out, which would...
Well, I think the bigger issue is, you know, we're all talking about common sense or what's reasonable, but that's in the eye of the beholder out there, because I have a feeling, you know, we're going to go through and do kind of the bare minimum, I think, this first go around, just to see what people's reaction is, but I wouldn't be surprised if we still get some angry.
Especially if somebody has to wait 15 more years.
Yeah.
20.
Yeah.
I don't think we'll ever make everybody happy, but I think we seem to be, I don't know, maybe I'm mistaken, but there might be a consensus here about just, you know, cleaning out the dry stuff and not necessarily surgically removing a whole bunch of...
Yeah, do we have to limb up? That's the real question.
Why?
I mean, there's a few areas where it makes sense, only a few areas, where you've got a lot of other stuff going on around it. And I don't know, John's also here, he's an expert in trees. The landscape design guys were telling me that they were limiting it up because they get diseases and because they're not supposed to be, because of all the other stuff on the ground. They removed like two dump trucks full of just old growth stuff just from, you know, 200 feet of landscaping that had been there. So they're saying lift it up because of disease, is basically what they're telling me. That's why I told them, can we just lift it up, you know, 2 feet instead of...
You're talking about the trees, not bushes. Is that correct?
The trees.
The redwoods, right?
Yeah, the redwoods.
So branches just lying on the ground or something like that?
I mean, just a lot of dead... I mean, I went in there with Marco and we were pulling out. There was underwear, spray paint cans. I mean, no one's touched that area beyond just mowing the weeds, probably since Gary left, at least. Maybe longer.
Future archaeological finds. Yeah. Great. Yeah, I would say less is more. But
is it less trimming or fewer plants?
Less trimming. But, you know, again, I think when I first heard about this, my main concern was fire. And the chief seems to have answered that. If we clean this up, it looks like, you know, any radical surgery on trees would not be necessary. There's the sight line issue that I think has been brought up, you know, where trees are in any way impinging on people's ability to see cars coming or bicyclists or whatever the case may be. I would say that those deserve some attention. But I think Irv's sort of pointed out what the berm is there for, and if we can keep that as intact as we possibly can, including the plantings, we're better off. But again, they should be doing their job.
Well, they're not going to follow the contract then, because that's what the guy kept coming up, bring back. This is what your this is what.
Well, okay.
We're executing your contract.
Let's look at that.
Yeah,
I thought the height said they just didn't have to do any trimming above 15 feet.
He told me not above 15 feet, but not to go more than a maximum. It was either 5 or 6 feet. I mean, obviously, depending on the height of the tree, you know, like the county went through and did 30 feet on these guys. And these guys aren't tree, they're not going to come through and do major tree work. Anyway, it's not what they're, you know, what we have them here for.
But if they don't, if they aren't required to take everything up 6 feet, if they say that's what the contract says, they shouldn't argue about that. That's less work for them to do.
No, I think they're ready to do whatever we want them to do, but they just want to know what that is.
Yeah. Right. So for all intents and purposes, I think what we're doing is we're listening to community feedback. We're hopefully going to alter the contract a little bit so that we can give them clear instruction on what they should be doing. Okay, so that folks that are dependent on the sound barriers, the privacy barriers, et cetera, aren't going to be, you know, maligned by whatever they do. So we can slightly alter the contract and give them proper instruction.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
I would also say, I mean, to Shane's credit, he spent a lot of time working with, you know, more of the management supervisors and land design as well. I mean, it's, I believe it was summer of 2014 was when the contract got implemented, so you're, you know, coming up on 3 years, about 2.5 years. They've gone through a couple cruise ships. We've noticed at one point in time they had a very solid crew that was kind of figured it out, had gained the lay of the land, had a good system to everything, and then for whatever reason that crew got reassigned or broken apart or new people came in, old people left. Then we noticed things starting to slip, and Shane's done a good job on following up with them. I mean, to the point of, to that point, you know, where they've credited us on this contract as well, of saying, okay, yeah, you're right, this needs to get done. What do we need to do to make it straight? And part of it is, well, you need to get it done. So the second part has been, you know, they've credited us a month or whatever the case may be on our billing, too. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, it's one of the challenges of working with an outsourced group like this. You try to remain as much consistency as you can through there, but at the end of the day, you know, different people are going to be kind of coming and going. You're not always going to have the same crew cycling through for years on, and it's, you know, so again, I think Shane's done a good job, and with that, just in my 2 years here, I know we've had some times, too, where we said, hey, we really need you to kind of hone in on this area for right now, so can you get that for us and take care of that, too? So we've kind of been, I don't want to say redirected them, but directed them to areas that we've identified as this really has to get done now, kind of a thing, you know, so.
I think you just provided or underscored the reason for having a very clear contract of what we want them to do.
Mm-hmm.
So, I'd be interested in what John has to say about this.
Okay.
Nothing? Okay. All right.
It sounds like I'm not completely familiar with what you're talking about. Oh. Basically, it's a screen along Lucas Valley Road that protects the adjacent property owners on the other side.
Mm.
So you can, I think, basically address your pruning issue from a point line that allows access and vision where it's needed, but you're basically just creating a wall of foliage behind a certain point.
Mm-hmm.
So I would work more to that end as opposed to individual landscape trees or species. Just prune more for screening.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, you can do that in your cuts. You create flat growth as opposed to, you know, working in or out. You kind of prune so it
fills in, so to
along
speak.
Along a flat line,
mm-hmm.
or like an espaliered plant. Kind of.
Left to right, less front and back, more right. Left to right kind of group.
Just pick that node and that node. And it seems like that's what you want in the end is a...
You should have planted a hedge.
Some privacy.
Yeah,
a hedge. Life a lot easier.
Okay.
You know, I'm happy to look at it at some point.
Yeah. So do we have a consensus on the direction that we're headed on this then?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
How do you guys feel about it?
I just have one maybe concern with Irv, and I wanted to follow up. When you, obviously you're of the mentality that you want a landscaped design out there, and to me landscape seems very structured and clean and cut, and is that what I'm hearing? Because I know that there are some people in Lucas Valley, like being right on Verbena, we like the natural. We, as natural as we can keep it and as private as we can keep it, we're happy. So I just wanted to see what you were thinking when you said you liked the landscape and that was the landscape effect, what that means to you. Does that mean skirting all the trees?
No, that's what I was saying. I don't know why the trees have to be lifted up, but I guess I don't 100% agree with John's idea of making a straight line. It seems to me you could keep a continuous line of foliage, but it could still be in sort of semicircular wherever there was a tree.
But not manicure, not like...
No, just...
No elephants.
Manicure.
I think it would look cool.
But I hear, yes.
We have one
building elephant. I think that's in the contract. I don't disagree, and I appreciate you all for coming down.
Well, I think our property is unique just because we're probably the only house. When I looked going up and down today, I think we're the only house that really has nothing. Yeah. We don't have the retaining wall, and we don't have a berm. We just have the tree, the redwood trees that Gary planted 15, 20 years ago.
For $4,000, you can
plant.
Hey, well, and,
the retaining wall.
No, they'd have to go through IRF.
Can I connect it?
But then it ought to be backfilled with dirt so that it adds to the berm.
Yeah, that's it.
Then you can skirt the tree if you need to.
I think,
in closing on what we're talking about here, the only other consideration factor is the overall health of those. I mean, at some point, leaving it natural actually is counterproductive in that it starts to overgrow, and then that starts to, some of those things then start to die off and such. I agree with the balanced approach, a conservative approach. There's no reason to go crazy out there, but I think at some point, if you don't start to get some of that overgrowth out of there, it will become counterproductive and actually start to have ill effects on a lot of those plantings that are already out there too. So
yeah, because we spent about $2,500 already removing trees separate from the contract, and there's still, like I said, two or three that we're going to have tree people actually come out and remove. But we can look at the really overcrowded areas and see what we can do while still leaving screening.
So we have the right direction then.
Yeah, well, yeah, we're not going to take the approach like the county took of, we're not going to be back here for 7 to 10 years because we haven't been here for 7 to 10 years, so just clear cut it, and in 7 to 10 years we'll need to do it again kind of a thing. Mm-hmm.
4 years. Understood.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Mm-hmm. The recreation and park maintenance activity reports.
Yeah, so if you want to start with recreation, this past Friday we just had our first homebrew happy hour, which was, I thought, was a success. We had between 55 and 60 people in attendance. Isabella's husband was the main brewmaster of the evening. He provided, I think, 5 out of the 7 beers. And we made some money because we didn't pay for any of the beer. So. But yeah, we had music, and by and large, everything I heard, everyone was positive, asking when we're doing something similar again.
So you're going to do happy hour every Friday?
No, not me at least.
yeah, Bill Shea's house.
Get like an ice cream truck.
Yeah.
And you're sell scotch.
Tacos.
The blood donation vehicle.
So I thought it was good. And yeah, we're going to be doing some more down the road. Not just homebrew, but we have like individual breweries come and wineries, etc. Keeping with the alcoholic theme, we have Raise a Glass scheduled for February 25th here from 2 to 5, which is one of our most popular events. I mean, we packed the room up with over, I think we had 150 people last time. I believe we have 11, if not 12 wineries.
Wow.
Live music, food, it's a good time, so definitely stop by for that. And then we have our largest event of the year, which is the egg hunt and breakfast with Bunny.
It's the shortest, isn't it?
Yes, and the shortest, which is sponsored by the Los Angeles Lions Club. They've been doing it for decades. And it is Saturday, April 15th, the day before Easter. The Marinwood Review is mailed out and is also available here at the community center. As I mentioned earlier, our summer camp registration for residents and pool members opens up tomorrow. So we are going to be very early, ready for that. And then it opens up to non-residents on the 27th. Our after-school program, Just to kind of give you guys an update, it's been going great. The staff have been doing a really good job. Parent feedback has been excellent. We just opened up registration for next year, and we're nearly full already. We did.
Wow.
We were able to add 5 more spaces. So it looks like we're on track to bring in a profit of about $30,000 this year, $40,000 for next year, which is a nice chunk to our budget. Pool, the park guys have been working diligently down there to get the pool up and running. We opened up this weekend for our first lifeguard training classes. So it's kind of a soft opening. We just basically will have the pool ready to go and everything fairly clean.
What was the damage in the pool itself? Some kind of shell cracks or whatever?
For our main pool?
Mm-hmm.
Our main pool is leaking, which I brought up in the past, and that's what we're going to be looking into. I actually have somebody coming in the next couple of weeks to give us an estimate on a replacement pool shell, which needs to happen every 7 to 10 years. I think we're at year 8.
Does that mean pouring cement?
Mm-hmm. A whole new shell, basically, yeah. And the top pool is in the same, if not worse, condition. These last rains filled the pool up, and it was empty within 3 days. So we're looking at doing we were leaking last year too, and we did an in-house repair. We'll probably be doing the same thing again to get it. So if you're going to do the main pool, you do the top pool at the same time. Everywhere.
What's the lifespan of the pour?
On average, it's 7 years, and I believe we're going into year 8. So
isn't there a plan to sort of reformat or redesign the tot pool
yeah.
when that happens?
When we have them come out, we're going to get same company does pool fabrication and design. So you know, getting just a basic, you know, enlarging it, putting in a new shell, and anytime you do anything to a tot pool now, you have to put in a zero entry, which is what we wire. So we'll be getting prices on that, so we have a better idea moving forward.
There's no deep end.
What's that?
There's no deep end.
There's a deep end, but you walk in instead of stepping in. It's that, you know, gradual slope. The beach kind of.
Put a diving
you walk
board
in, you don't fall in.
Yeah.
That's the idea.
Jesus, God.
And lastly, we've been holding, we've held our preschool director interviews to replace Susan Press. We just held our second round of interviews this last week, and we're down to 2 candidates, and they're coming to shadow just so they can have a complete idea of what the position entails, and then we'll be making a decision in the next 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
So that's all direct.
Awesome.
Park maintenance, same old, same old. Staff's really still been dealing with fallout from the storms. In between, we're just trying to get clean things up around here. Mainly, like I said, we're focusing on the pool to get it up and running. But they've been, you know, the park guys have been up in the open space quite a bit, dealing with, the chief and I and Marco went up and inspected the fire roads a couple weeks ago.
Is that any movement on that since?
Not since the chief and I, when the chief and I went up there, I've been up there 3 times now, and it continues to get worse. So we'll see.
So your fire roads?
Yeah, and the fire roads.
Well, that fire road was growing over
that one's actually
horribly.
Slated to be turned into a single track at some point, but Queenstown's in bad shape and I'm trying to figure out what to do about it.
So there's a lot of erosion on Queenstown right now.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so
what's slide watch look like these days?
Better than dam watch.
Mm.
Yeah.
Better than dam watch.
Thank God for
that.
Small favors. I mean, is it getting to the point of concern?
Yeah, it's past that point, I think.
Okay.
I don't know where it's going
to
go, though.
It looks like it's going to go. According to, you know, like I said, I brought Tom Hornet there just because he's has a background in geology.
Mm-hmm.
And he was saying that it looked like, you know, if it goes, when it goes, it's not going to be anywhere as big as the Pawnee. And the houses are much, where it's kind of recessed back, it doesn't look like it would affect any houses down below. But
should they be informed at all?
I don't know.
It's
Pacheco Valley, right? Yeah, it's Pacheco. It's pretty far away from the houses, but I mean, you know, I don't know what it looked like when Pawnee went. Supposedly Pawnee also went up, like the top part came.
It's a lot.
It took out the whole fire road.
Yeah, some decks and stuff below. I mean, maybe. I don't know, to be honest with you. I've been going up there once every 2 weeks just to see what the status is. It looks like if just the area that's cracking goes, mm-hmm. it's not going to cause any major damage. If for some reason that caused something else from up above, which I believe is what happened with Pontiac, I'm not sure, then you'd have a bigger issue. But I don't know how you would, we'd have to get, you know.
How to figure that out, yeah.
But if this is that, I mean, on one hand you would want them informed, but on the other hand, if we create panic where there's really...
It doesn't look as, like it could be as drastic as Pontiac. I mean, and the county park guys, you know, went out there and saw it, and they said, "Hey, just heads up that it looks like this is good." They didn't sound too alarmed.
They did not.
No, but I mean, it's not their property, so they don't really care either.
Well, but I mean, they know more about stuff like this, and Tom knows more about right. than you and I, right? Right? So if we were to
yeah, at some point, I mean, when the dust settles, I mean, maybe we should get something out there just to look at it. And maybe at the same time just assess the work they've done on Pony to make sure that it's holding the way it should.
Is it cracking in the road and it look the outside of the road is
yes.
failing?
Yes.
Is there any water coming down the road that's getting yes. into those cracks?
We've diverted it.
Okay, you answered my question.
The best we could, but there's still a lot of water that coming from up above. Most of the water was coming down the trail, so yeah, we've diverted it. Just kind of the same technique that the county does on their portions of the fire road, which they create like little berms and just kind of siphon it off well before the area in question. Hmm. But
the trick is just keep it as dry as you can.
Yeah, if you want to come walk up there with me, or if we can go take a look at it at your leisure.
I'm going to, but it's in a couple of weeks.
That's fine. So, other good news. Well, this is good news. The truck is scheduled for delivery March 1st, the new park truck. So we're hoping that's on schedule. Right now the dump truck is also at the county garage with some issues, so we don't have a vehicle other than the UTVs that we have to get around. I'll broach the subject. The creek.
The creek.
The creek, which has brought us nothing but joy this last season. We have slides in certain areas and a lot of trees down, but one of the bigger areas of concern is right behind the pump room. It's eroding really quickly back there. In between the pump room and the fence which leads to the creek, a shed was built in-house maybe 15 years ago.
Yeah.
In that shed, there's now, you know, it's cracking right where the shed is.
The shed's going to collapse.
Yeah, the shed has been basically, no one's allowed to go in there at this point. And it's somewhat attached to the building. You know, we did it in-house, so I don't think it's really like structurally attached to it.
Should we dismantle the shed?
Well, and that's what Irv recommended. He sent us a list of things to look at kind of in order. I was back there today, and yeah, we should. We're kind of coming up with a plan since the, you know, you can get in from the front and the back, but the main side you'd be working is the side that's falling into the creek. So we're kind of looking at how we would safely make access.
Is this attached to the pump house or something?
Yeah. Yeah, it was built by, I don't know if you remember Gene, Gary's assistant Gene.
Jaggers.
Yeah. It was built back there for extra storage, and it's attached so that, you know, moisture and water doesn't get in. So I don't know if it's, I don't think it's really like anchored to the...
It abuts it, kind of like, think about the maintenance facility.
Let's not.
Yeah. It's a building that comes up alongside of the other building, but I don't think it uses the original pump house as a anchor system.
And how much stuff is in there?
Everything's been taken out. We took everything out of there months ago. But the bigger kind of issue is Luke and I walked behind there, and it looks, it's kind of just a sheer cliff. And it's not only just a sheer cliff, it's undercutting, and there's like hole like going pretty far. It's something that we need to look at as far as like actually getting somebody out here to look at.
Is this undermining the pump house? Is that what you're talking about?
Eventually. I think it's very possible. If it went like that creek over, you know, where we lost that portion, where we lose, you know, 6 feet, 7 feet at a time, we'd be
Good, huge.
Opening a skate park.
Yeah, so I mean, I'm thinking, you know, we actually need somebody to come. I mean, we're going to most likely be moving forward with needing to.
So help me understand this, because on one hand, I keep on hearing you can't touch the creek side. You can't do anything to shore up the creek side. But it sounds like we have no choice.
I mean, you can, but you go, there's quite a bit of a process that would need to take place to do anything in the creek, especially now. And it's not going to be one of those projects where you're putting boulders down, you know. It's a straight, well, it's something where, I mean, maybe your Eric can speak to it, but it looks like something that you need to pump a concrete wall or steel wall into that would be, you know, vertical, straight up and down.
Is that possible to?
Yeah, it's the only hard part, and I didn't look at it from that standpoint, and that's, you need to get a, be able to reach a crane over there that has a drill bit on it to drill holes, and then you put steel I-beams in the ground and then slide either timber or concrete panels between the I-beams. And probably then put some rock in front of it because what you don't want to do is have a smooth edge to the creek. It just speeds up the water.
Yeah, right.
But, you know, yes, you need to have a geotech look at it. And, you know, at the same time, want to look at least the one big problem down in the park.
Mm-hmm.
But another thing, I don't know if Eric has done it or is find out, I assume the county was declared a disaster area by the Board of Supervisors, but I'm not sure.
Yes.
Okay, but then we need to find out how this district can apply for federal funds.
The last time that I saw, and I do need to follow up some more, is that it applied only to the roads. Not the county just as a whole, tell us, you know, your OES issue. The chief definitely knows more people on the OES side than I do.
No, I'll find out tomorrow.
Yeah, we can work. Yeah.
Is there any way we could, maybe you could hang out with Damon and show him the situation here? I mean,
yeah, I have actually, Damon's on my radar for something else, so we'll reach out to him tomorrow. And I know Tom Jordan pretty well at the OES office. I'll find out what's covered and what's not.
Yeah. Well, I know it's pretty standard for cities and counties to be able to go after these emergency funds. Mm-hmm. But I know from storms past that the Marin Municipal Water District was able to go after those same kind of funds for some slides they had. And this is the same kind of thing. We're a special district, just like the water district mm-hmm. is. Yeah. And they were eligible. But I don't know, you know, the order of things. But it seems like it ought to be looked at because it seems, you know, you're talking big bucks.
I mean, losing this infrastructure is basically killing our summer season.
Yeah.
And impacting negatively our major revenue source, which is the summer camps.
Well, probably you aren't going to be able to do anything in the way of work there till this summer anyway.
Yeah.
No, right. But
we got to get going, I guess, so we can do it before next year's rains.
Or before, you know, not only the shed, but also the pool house just collapses into the creek.
Yeah.
So it's urgent. I'm terrified, kind of.
Wow.
See, if the pool house itself starts to crack, I think, and we need to talk to county council or somebody, this board could declare an emergency, and you just go and fix it right now. But, you know, and you don't mess, there's no bidding, there's no permits. You, after the fact, you come back and say, now we need to permit what we've done and finish it so that it's permanent.
Is our own insurance cover it?
I have no idea.
Through P&L, as mentioned, it may and it may not. Most property and liabilities don't look at quote-unquote natural disaster.
I thought they adjusted the insurance from after Ponte.
That was one of the things I wanted to bring up to the auditor. Did I read this right? We have a $1 billion per occurrence coverage. $1 billion? Wow. Okay.
There's a $5 million deductible.
Yeah. Anyway, I would think that, you know, Shane needs to keep watching that. The minute he sees the first indication of cracking of that pool building.
You mean water coming in through the brick?
No.
That started for the first time.
No, I mean you actually see some structural movement.
Yeah, I go out there every day just to watch the...
But I think if that happens, we need to have an emergency board meeting and make some decisions as an emergency...
Can we do that?
I don't know. Maybe we ought to ask county council ahead of time if we can do that.
You can have an emergency board meeting, and the board can certainly declare things that, you know, at the end of the day... It's not like you have a reserve fund to dip into or anything like that either.
Jerry would be willing to help us out, wouldn't he?
Who?
Jerry.
Garcia? He left a long time ago.
No. Mr. Brown.
Yeah, well, that's the point of looking at the OES declarations and seeing how we might be able to get in on some of that, following up with insurance, so on and so forth, and seeing where does this stand.
And speaking of just the creek, with so many trees coming down, that's going way over budget too, aren't we?
Yeah, not yet. We're pretty much saturated. Anything else moving forward, we're going to be going over budget.
Because we're looking at heavy rains coming
tomorrow
for, what, 5 or 6 days in a row they're talking about?
Yeah, I mean, a lot of the stuff, the park guys have been able to take care of a decent amount of it, and some of the stuff can wait until the creek recedes, and then the park guys can take care of it. But yeah, as of now, we've maxed it out.
It's been a costly winter.
Yes, it has.
To cut down the eucalyptus tree?
They came last Thursday and were spinning around in the mud and decided it wasn't a good idea to cut it down that day, so they'll be back.
I was also told that there was a berm up there and they decided to take that out and more water was rushing down into the yards.
Wait, what?
There was a berm put in by the homeowner.
Oh.
Up there, and they took it out, and when it rained,
the water
was rushing down like it was 10 years ago when that channel was blocked by a tree.
Yeah.
And the water came rushing down to, what, 3 or 4 homes, something like that.
Who's so, they?
Yeah.
People who took the
people that owned it. Own the house that where the tree fell into.
The ones who took the burn out?
So they
no,
they
no, no. Evidently, Tad's group took it out.
For access?
When they stopped by there Thursday, that's what I was told.
I mean, they were only there for like 20 minutes. I saw them like driving the...
They came in the back way.
Yeah, they came in, they drove right next to where the concrete culvert was, but I didn't see them put in like anything that was walking.
I don't know, that's what I was told, because Gavin and I were walking by on Miller Creek on Saturday.
I'll have to go take a look.
Seriously, downtown took anything.
Would it be worth it? Yeah. I don't know. I'm not sure if you said you were doing it already. To talk to county council about what our powers are in an emergency situation, if we get into one, so that we don't have to go ask it. You know, I'm trying. If something starts to happen, I'd like to be able to move fast and know we're doing it halfway right.
You can call an emergency meeting and...
I'm not talking about the meeting.
Right.
The meeting would be to do some action.
Right.
To get someone to fix something.
Sure.
There's always the old adage, it's easier to ask.
But you have the power to do that. My question still remains, what resources are you going to utilize to do it with?
Yeah.
That's the conundrum.
Insurance or emergency funds from the county or state?
Pre-spending measure of money, I guess.
That won't even cover it, though. I don't think that. No,
close.
No, wait.
You're
talking
$50,000 to $80,000, probably, and just to get something started there that would protect the building.
Well, and keep in mind too that pool building goes underground quite a bit from where it's perched. I mean, it's got a pretty deep pit down there as well. It's built of solid concrete that forms basically underneath the whole thing where all the giant pumps are and the motors.
Yeah, this is the first year, like I was saying, we started getting water seeping in from the concrete down there. Like, you could see water, like, pouring in.
Through the walls?
Mm-hmm. Down the bottom, like, because it's underground. But I've never seen that before, neither at the park area, so. Good things are happening right now. I wish this rain would stop so we could actually get a closer look at it.
Last year you were probably saying, I wish it would rain.
No, I didn't care.
No,
Yeah, back to your comment, I don't think the dust is going to settle for quite some months.
Yeah, unfortunately.
It'd be interesting to see if we ever have dust again. Oh, question. How are we doing on the old supplies out at the maintenance shed? If you know what I'm saying.
Everything is, I mean, we brought a large debris bin in 2 weeks ago and continued to clear stuff out. Mm-hmm. We've had the most water we've ever had in the right-hand side. Mm-hmm. And again, we're only using that at this point to store vehicles. We don't have any real supplies in there. But yeah, things are continuing to get organized. Mm-hmm. And we're discovering a lot of things that we didn't know existed, so.
I see.
Yeah.
But as far as like hazardous stuff and this and that?
Yeah, I don't think there's anything. I mean, we accumulate stuff sparingly. It needs to go every quarter or something. We go and take a look to see what we have, if anything needs to be recycled. But we finished, before the end of summer, we got rid of everything that...
You did?
Yeah.
Oh, good.
Cost us a little bit of money, but yeah.
I understand.
Yeah.
Very good. Okay, thanks.
Any other questions? Anybody? The next Park and Rec Commission meeting is February 28th. On to new and other business, requests for future meeting agenda items.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Just the shed to be spending item of business and the pool equipment room.
Or why not call it creek status, because there's another major area down the way a little too.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, I have another item. Senate Bill 415 is going to require all local government agencies, including special districts, to change their election cycle of their general elections, meaning basically directors from odd number of years to even number of years to coincide with the state general election. It happens in various phases. Right now, the one sense of potential urgency is, in short, if we wanted to submit a resolution to the Board of Directors to forego the 2017 or Board of Supervisors 2017 director election to 2018 to start to move into compliance with this law, that would need to be done and submitted by March 10th. That would require calling a special meeting for that purpose to put it together. I've done some research on this in the last couple of days. Today especially, it's not a huge process in terms of designing a resolution for it goes. I've gotten several samples. What it would mean is it would extend all of your terms by 1 year. So rather than your term expiring for Bill and for Irv in November of 2017, it would expire in November of 2018. And instead of the remaining members going down to 2019, you would go to 2020. The option is, right now, if we don't do that, the 2017 election goes on as said. Those people would be elected to 4-year terms, but the board at some point in time is going to have to extend terms of current sitting board members for another year, in the sense that has been, I believe, the deadline for everything to get turned in is December 31st of 2017, stating a plan.
So this is a law current?
This is a law current, Senate Bill 415.
2015, it was enacted.
If you had the 2017 election, could the term be for 3 years, and then you're on track?
No.
That's too simple.
Nice try.
Yeah.
Since we have to adjust the terms regardless whether we extend this year or next year, like we may as well just apply for it now.
Well, that's something to be discussed, but I don't think we can get into too deep of a conversation. I'm happy to send some information out tomorrow that I have gotten put together, and also if you just Google Senate Bill 415 election terms, you'll find it. A lot of local districts, I know the local school district, the county office of ed has put this forth. A lot of people are basically submitting already by now to simply extend, forego their next election, push it back a year in all terms. Consequently, get a year added to it of your current sitting board.
Could we call a special meeting?
Sure we can. Just so everyone knows, if you want to go out and look at the Dixie School Board agenda for, what, yesterday?
I believe so.
I think it was yesterday.
Their meeting is right now.
Oh, it could be today, yeah. I mean, it gives a very clear line of what has to happen and when.
The elections department provided me a sample of the one that the county office put together as generic for the school district, so, you know, it's got the right coding in it. I actually sent something out through listserv on the CSDA today, and had several responses of people who sent me back things. So, like I said, ultimately it would add a year to all of your terms. So instead of ending in 2017, Bill and Irv would extend till 2018, and instead of ending in 2019 for Jeff, Isabel, and Leah, you'd extend to 2020.
Talk about conflict of interest. We're voting ourselves in for another year.
Yeah, there was a lot.
It was written in, though, because it's amazing the vast majority of local governments who have election for their boards in the odd number of years. The rationale behind it is, A, expense. It's cheaper to consolidate it with the statewide elections and everything else, and primarily also voter turnout, which according to the elections department is anywhere from 30% to 40% higher in even number statewide election years than it is for odd number general election.
I guess we should do it then.
Okay, yeah. I will put something up.
We need to also discuss ballot initiatives and moving the ballot initiatives along with the elections.
Sure.
You know, because yeah. I mean, it's silly to have elections every single year.
Yeah, I would personally, I don't disagree with you. Right now, the next ballot initiatives aren't set to go on until 2019. So you certainly could look at moving those to 2018. I don't think that's a decision we have to make within this meeting.
Yeah.
I think within this meeting, I'll look at availability for everybody. It'll probably be a 20 minute meeting max. If you do it as a single item and the only item that comes on is this, it needs a minimum of 24 hours notice to the public. I would suggest 48, if not 72, to get it out there in the standard timeline that we do for this. Won't be hard to put the resolution together. And from all of my research, the vast majority of districts that I've been in contact with, this is how they've done it.
Okay.
There may be the possibility of also having something to report about the creek. If we're going to have a special meeting,
yeah,
and we've got information to share on that, that could be another topic.
I don't blame you. I will send out a survey tomorrow to look for available dates of the board.
Okay. Any other agenda items?
Let's see. Boy, I had a couple, but they sort of don't seem so important right now. Anyway, I was just going to mention something. I think this has been mentioned in the past. I'm not sure if it's ever gone anywhere, but I would certainly find it helpful as a board member to have a list of milestones, annual milestones of when certain, you know, important events happen, like when we can expect tax revenues to be deposited in our account, when we need to vote on certain things, when we need to appoint people to certain things, you know, major milestones for perhaps the park, the fire department, just so we had a check, sort of a calendar that says, here's where these things are happening, just so we can, you know, keep our eye on them.
I would have liked something like that when I came on too.
Yeah. annual budget reviews, board assignments, periodic reviews of capital reserves, you know, those kind of things. Just not only for the board members, but just so that staff can also anticipate when we're going to need to sit down and look at those things and make sure that they're fresh and not completely, you know, wacky. So anyway, that's something I would like to propose.
Did I make a request? Seems like you've kind of started at least a mental list of things that should go on there. Can you send that to me, please? It'll help me think of what all else should go on there as well.
As soon as I figure out my fee structure, I'll let you know. Yeah, so. Yeah, that'll be fine.
Thank you.
You bet.
Anything else? Anybody?
Got creek status OES, SB 415 as a special meeting, and then the board annual events list as of now.
So I'm not going to talk about video equipment, but I was going to. Okay, I'm done.
I feel bad that it's not here tonight.
Yes.
Okay, then I'm going to go on to L, recognitions and board member items of interest. Isabel?
I will, but after Eric, because he was...
I got the Marinwood review in the mail a couple of days ago, and it was fantastic, I thought. I always thought, we're just a little district that does our little thing, but that thing was just great.
Shane and Paul and the rec crew spend a lot of time on it.
Yeah, thanks. I'll pass on to Paula. She puts it together.
It seems like it improves each time, too.
Yeah.
It was pretty nice.
Like a telephone book.
Well, it's definitely funny when you look at it compared to Santa Fe's.
Yeah.
Santa Fe's is about a dozen pages, it feels like nowadays, and well, they're a much larger municipality and rec district than we are. Paula does a good job putting it together. Carolyn pitches in, Shane pitches in, Luke and Robin.
They did a great job.
We will make sure that they're all approved of that. Thank you.
Anything else?
I have two recommendations.
There you go.
That's right. I later don't think. first to Irv for sharing your knowledge and expertise. So invaluable and so helpful to the district. Thank you so much. And to the park crew and to Shane for fighting the elements and doing all that you're doing.
Losing battle, but yeah.
You know what? Nature wins. Nature wins, but it's humbling. But thank you for all you do. Okay. Please forward my sincere thanks.
I definitely will.
Yes, Jeff?
I wanted to wait until after the audit was done, but I wanted to recognize and thank Eric and Carolyn for their incredible efforts in moving to the QuickBooks accounting system.
Yeah.
This is not a trivial undertaking. There was risk involved, a lot of hard work, I'm sure a lot of long hours, and passing that audit and getting it accepted this evening was a major accomplishment. Thank you both for your efforts.
I would just close it, too, and ask Isabella to once again express the gratitude of the district to Damien for coming and doing that homebrew event for us. He definitely made it.
He was in his element.
He certainly was. And if my garage had one of those nifty little machines in it that he brought over, I would simply never leave. Not have a problem. But that's a different story. But anyway, please again tell him we said thank you very much.
Awesome. Well, if nobody has anything...
I have one quote-unquote board member item of interest. I'd expected this to be videotaped tonight, so... But anyway, there is a group called the Coalition of Sensible Taxpayers that has been formed recently. This is separate and distinct from the sustainable pension folks. They're holding their inaugural meeting at the Spinnaker Restaurant in Sausalito tomorrow evening, starting at 6:30. Joe Nation is the leading pension expert and Stanford professor who will be actually presenting at that meeting. I'm actually planning on attending. I just wanted to make sure that people were aware of it.
Thank you.
Tomorrow,
6:30. Ironic acronym there, huh?
Mm.
Cost.
Cost, yes.
Wow.
Do you guys get the email about passing of Ron's wife?
Yes.
Email Ron at all.
Oh, right.
I'd like you guys to reach out to him. He's having a rough
day. Thank you, Chief. I forgot about that. Definitely.
Yeah, thanks for that reminder. Good point.
Well, if nothing else. All those in favor?
I'm a little too driven by common sense and logic tonight. I missed some argumentative
Way to go.
That turned out longer than I
expected.
At one point, I was ahead of time, and then we started talking about
which is what I think.